A very good morning and welcome to the sixth meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2023. There are no apologies this morning. And our first item of business today is consideration of the Scottish Prison Service's urgent case review and the housing of transgender prisoners. And I refer members to paper one. So I intend to allow around 45 minutes for the session after any opening statements. And I welcome to the meeting this morning Keith Brown, Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans, Mr. Neil Rennick, Director for Justice at the Scottish Government, and Ms. Theresa Medhurst, Chief Executive of the Scottish Prison Service. So I'll now invite Ms. Medhurst, followed by the Cabinet Secretary, to make some brief opening remarks.
Good morning, Convener, Committee Members, and if you wouldn't mind excusing me, I have got a bit of a cold, so I'll try and work through that as we go through the session this morning. Thank you for inviting me this morning. I hope this session will allow me the opportunity to provide you all with greater clarity and understanding about how the Scottish Prison Service manages all people in our care. Whilst I know the focus today is on the management of transgender individuals, my priority remains the health, safety and well-being of everyone who visits, lives and works in our prisons, some of whom, as well as the most marginalised and vulnerable in our society. The Scottish Prison Service has a proven track record of managing complex people. Society in general is subject to constant change, and these changes in time impact in our own prison communities and affect how we manage those in our care. This requires us to evolve and adapt our operations to meet new challenges and changing dynamics. Every single person sent to us by the courts comes with their own history and life circumstances that define them as individuals. That is why an individualised, person-centred approach is fundamental to our role as custodians and our position within the widest justice sector as a modern prison service. On a daily basis, prison officers have to manage a range of often conflicting demands and risks presented to them by the individuals we care for. These can range from an individual that's a known, serious and organised crime group to a first-time offender of whom we have little or no knowledge. Decisions on the management and placement of individuals, including transgender individuals, are made on an individual basis, informed by a multidisciplinary assessment of both risk and need. Such decisions seek to protect both the well-being and the rights of the individual, as well as that of those around them, including staff, in order to achieve an outcome that balances risks and promotes the safety of all people who live and work in prisons. As part of our approach to operational risk assessment, proportionate management controls such as removing an individual from contact with the wider population or additional security measures will be introduced where new information suggests that it is necessary. Such decisions are not taken lightly. And when required, the key consideration is always safety and not punishment. This balanced approach helps to manage a perceived risk or threat whilst continuing to support the well-being of the individual with the aim of integrating the person into an appropriate mainstream location as soon as practicable. The population dynamic, which is constantly shifting and changing, can be affected by both internal and external factors. This requires a responsiveness through well-established and well-practiced operating systems in managing intelligence, profiling risks, tactical interventions, and applying individualised case management approach through managing our policies and practice. With the foundation of the approach being the relationships that exist and are developed between our staff and those in our care. These relationships are key in building a solid foundation to deliver effective services. They support people through difficult times, guiding them through their journey whilst in custody and preparing them for an eventual return to society. I have over 30 years operational experience working in prisons. They are unique environments in comparison to other parts of the public sector. I've been the governor in charge in both male and the female estate and have managed both trans women and trans men in custody. I also led the development of our transformative women's strategy in response to the Dame Eilish Angelini report in 2012, which is delivering a step change in how we manage women in our care. Our trauma-informed and innovative strategy is supporting women to regain their independence and learn skills that will support a best possible chance of a return, successful return to their communities. The SPS remains committed to providing person-centred care to our entire population, including managing identified risks, which are not exclusive to transgender people in custody. This is supported by our staff, who themselves continue to demonstrate their long-standing expertise and a strong track record in the management and care of an increasingly complex prison population. Finally, I would reiterate the point I made at the start of my statement, and that is my priority remains the health, safety and well-being of our staff and everyone in our care. Thank you very much, Convener.
Thank you very much. Cabinet Secretary, I'll just hand over straight to you.
Thanks very much, Convener, and thank you for the opportunity to be here today to answer questions regarding the management of transgender prisoners and the recommendations of the Urgent Case Review. There have, of course, been concerns expressed about this, and it's important to provide assurance around the safety of all people in the care of SPS. In a democracy, of course, it's perfectly legitimate to raise questions and seek reassurance. However, the wider discussion around gender identity has risked, in my view, stigmatising transgender people, and this will have a real and direct impact on both transgender people and the broader community of which they are part. As MSPs, it falls on us, in my view, to provide responsible, rational and compassionate leadership. And I hope the committee will agree that it would be abhorrent if any legitimate scrutiny of this matter is allowed to fuel the view that trans women somehow pose an inherent risk to women. That is clearly not the case, and I remain concerned that this view is even further marginalising trans individuals. As in any discussion involving the criminal justice system, we must also never forget that the victims who will be affected by these instances are also affected by the things that we say. That is true, too, of the specific case to which the Lesson Learned Review relates, and I pay tribute to those women for their bravery. As I said in Parliament, I am keen that the discussion around this issue and the Lessons Learned Review are calm and founded on fact. I am confident that approached in this way, you will be reassured around both the lessons learned and the wider management of individuals within the care of the Scottish Prison Service. Again, I would commend the SPS's expertise. You've just heard some of the bona fides of people involved in that process, and also their track record of managing the risk posed by individuals in their care. There have already been a number of high-profile individuals that have been discussed in the media and mentioned in Parliament. I'm also aware that there are other transgender individuals within the prison estate who have been living within their allocated establishment for lengthy periods of time without any issue or concern. It remains a long-standing principle of the Scottish Government and the Scottish Prison Service that we do not comment on individual cases, and while this approach has been particularly challenging in this instance, I do not consider it appropriate to forensically examine the details of every individual case in a public forum. The current SPS policy around the management of transgender individuals has been in place from 2014. On the 29th of January this year, as a result of the specific circumstances of the case that's been mentioned, I announced that a number of interim measures had been decided by the SPS, and these were that, first of all, no transgender person already in custody with a history of violence against women, which includes sexual offences against women, would be moved from the male to the female estate. In addition, no newly convicted or remanded transgender prisoner with any history of violence against women would be placed in the female estate. Any case that required such a move would be in exceptional circumstances and would require to be approved by ministers. A lessons learned review into the circumstances of the Isla Bryson case was also conducted by the SPS, and I'm very grateful to the Prison Service for doing this work and for the conclusions and the recommendations which they've made. While a full report will not be published due to the significant amount of personal data of both the individual and SPS staff, I wrote to the committee on the 9th of February regarding this and published a letter and key recommendations from SPS, and it may be helpful to mention briefly some of the key points in that. As you've heard, Theresa Medhurst has confirmed that SPS policy was followed during each decision-making process and risk assessment. Most significantly, she's also confirmed that at no time during this period were any women in SPS care at risk of harm as a consequence of the management of the individual. I am mindful that this assurance points to the effective operation of SPS practice and the existing policy. She has also confirmed that after the initial risk assessment procedure and multidisciplinary case conference undertaken in terms of that policy, the individual concerned was transferred to and remains in the male estate. As additional assurance, full multidisciplinary reviews are also currently underway for each transgender person in custody. The Scottish Prison Service has indicated that the protective measures originally put in place would be amended to take account of the lessons learned review and developing operational experience. Critically, it remains the case that any transgender person currently in custody and who has any history of violence against women, including sexual offences, will not be relocated from the male to the female estate. However, SPS has decided that any newly convicted or remanded transgender prisoner, not just those with a history of violence against women, will initially be placed in an establishment commensurate with their birth gender. This wider measure reflects operational practicalities that I'm sure Theresa will be able to talk to if you require, but in light of the lessons learned review, highlighting the lack of available information sharing at the pre-custody and post-admission stage, this is a precautionary approach which I commend. Again, in exceptional circumstances where a move contrary to these measures was required, ministerial approval would be required and sought. A key area for improvement from the lessons learned review is for improved information sharing and communication between justice partners to SPS to allow advanced alert to ensure that there is a clearer approach to the transfer of transgender individuals from the court to SPS custody. The review also supported the current approach to individualised risk assessments and the balancing of rights, but highlighted the need to consider improvements to the admissions process, particularly around the weight attached to an individual's offending history. Theresa has indicated that she has accepted these recommendations and SPS has started work to action them. The SPS has confirmed that the lessons learned will also feed into their ongoing review of their policy for the management of transgender prisons. As you've heard, the management of any group of prisoners will involve an element of risk. Clearly, this is not unique to prisoners who are transgender. The approach that the SPS takes must be based on its legal obligations, on the human rights and trauma-informed approach that it takes to all those in its care, and crucially, to protecting the safety of all prisoners and staff. And along with the Chief Executive, I'm happy to answer any questions that the committee has on these issues. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Cabinet Secretary. So we're now going to move to questions, and I intend to allow 45 minutes for members to ask questions. And with that, I'm going to hand straight over to Russell Finlay, and then I'll bring in Rona Mackay. Russell.
Thank you, Convener. And I'd like to echo what the Cabinet Secretary said about this not being about suggesting trans women are inherently pose some kind of threat. This has always been about predatory men exploiting gender self-ID, and which is indeed why we're here today to talk about this particular case. Now, a victim of this male-bodied double rapist and his wife says claim to be trans is a sham. You have told the BBC that in this case you need to accept people identify as women. Nicola Sturgeon has repeatedly been unable to answer this particular question in relation to this individual. Kate Forbes has said that no rapist can be a woman. Isla Bryson is a man. So who is right?
I'm not here to discuss other people's views. I'm here as the Justice Secretary to answer questions about the policy that we have in the prison service.
But if this goes to the heart of the...
I just finish my point. If you've asked a question...
We've got very little
want
time.
To ask that question, then ask a question that you want after I finish my answer, please.
If I can come in, we're here to discuss the specifics of the lessons learned review. Okay. I would be grateful if you could confine your questions
review. Okay, but the reason I think the question is relevant is because this goes to the heart of where we are now. The prison service is conducting a review. If senior politicians in the governing party all give different answers to a very basic question about this particular offender, that is germane to it. And if you're not prepared to answer that, that's fine. I'll move on, but I can give you another opportunity if you like.
If I answer, you just wouldn't allow me to answer. That was the point I was trying to make.
If you'd
can
like
I
to
try
answer?
And answer it now?
Who's right then in terms of definition?
Again, you're asking the same question, so I'd ask you to ask another question.
Can I just say I'm happy to answer the question, but I would like to try and get through the answer before being interrupted, if possible. I think the responsibilities I have as Justice Secretary and the responsibilities I have for the prison state, in my view, are what are germane here. So just to mention that the prison rules, and it goes to the point that Mr Finlay's made, are able to self-declare that they are transgender and are supported to express the gender or non-gender with which they identify, with staff using correct pronouns. I think that's important to mention because that is the rules in England and Wales. That's underpinned by UK legislation over many years, and that is a process that we follow in the prisons in Scotland.
When did you find out that this particular prisoner had been sent to a women's prison?
When it became evident in the media. I would not normally uniformly be told of every prisoner that was being sent to prison.
So even though it was quite a high-profile, ongoing High Court case where people were aware of this issue, nobody had informed you?
I've just answered that question.
OK. So once the transfer did become known about, you initially defended the decision. The following day, the First Minister announced that the prisoner was being removed. Do you now regret defending that decision initially?
I think I've said at the time to Parliament that I had faith in the base, in the basis upon which the Scottish Prison Service deals with prisoners who are transgender. They have an extremely strong track record in doing that. They have managed to protect women, they've managed to protect other prisoners, and they've managed to protect their staff. I expressed that support for the prison service at the time, and I'm happy to express it again now.
OK, so on January 31st, you told the Parliament, and I quote, "The SPS was, of course, aware of ministers' views. It would be frankly bizarre if the SPS had not been aware of ministers' views," and that was in respect of the decision to remove this prisoner from the female estate. So how exactly were those views made known?
Well, I think you've just mentioned there was a substantial degree of publicity around that, and obviously ministers have discussions with officials and the agencies for which they have responsibility. As I say, the process that was followed in this case was the process that's always followed. I had faith in that process. And of course, there's very little evidence to suggest that the way that this individual prisoner was dealt with would have been different in any other circumstances. So I'll just repeat the point. I do have faith in the Scottish Prison Service's ability to deal with it. The changes which were announced, I've just mentioned those in my opening statement, were to provide further reassurance. And I think that was the right thing to do.
How were the views made known to the prison service?
I'll just explain that, convener.
Okay, if I can maybe...
I'm not entirely sure we know how the government communicated to the prison service its dissatisfaction with this prisoner being in the female estate. And I don't think, I think, you know, given that we've got this partial review in front of us, it doesn't explain that. I think it's a perfectly reasonable question. Maybe the prison service can tell us how the government made its views known.
Ms. Meadows.
So the, there was a conversation during which I was asked about the where we were in the case management of that individual, because the case management process obviously applies almost immediately, particularly where somebody is held in segregation. And it was during that conversation with officials that I was made aware of ministers' views on that. But what I would say, and I'll make this very clear, that the placement of prisoners, unless it is a policy matter, is an operational matter for the SPS. So that decision was taken by operational people in respect of both the initial placement of the individual and the subsequent decision to move the individual. It was in no way a ministerial decision. It was for SPS and for operational people.
So going back to the contact, was it a conversation instigated by government officials? They contacted you?
It was a telephone call to me, yes.
From the Justice Directorate or from...
It's from me.
Right. Explaining that the Justice Secretary and the First Minister had concerns.
Explaining that that there were ministerial concerns within government, and there were there was a requirement to understand where we were in the process. That's what I was asked. I then obviously checked where we were in the process. But as I say, the decisions that were taken in respect of an individual case, which should not be discussing, any decision on the operational placement of an individual is for the prison service.
So the representation that was made to you was more general, as in we have these concerns, not any suggestion that you should act in a certain way?
No, there was no suggestion that I should act. It was general concerns about the placement of the individual, and a request to better understand where we were in the process. Is that fair?
If I can maybe just move things on so that other members have got an opportunity to ask questions, and if we've got time, I will come back. So I'm going to bring in Rona Mackay, and then I'll bring in Pauline McNeill.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. I'd like to ask Ms Medhurst, just for clarity, how long have the prison service been managing transgender prisoners in Scotland?
To the best of my knowledge, for at least 15 years. And that has included both trans men and trans women. And I have experience of managing both in the male estate and in the female estate.
Okay, thank you. In the lessons learned review, you have said that newly convicted or remanded transgender prisoners will initially be placed in an establishment commensurate with their birth gender. I'm just wondering, is there a timescale on that, and how long, how long do you expect that to be? And does the individual have to appeal themselves to be moved to a different prison?
So the intent that was set out by the Cabinet Secretary in his statement on the, I think it was the 29th of January, give a clear indication of the types of individuals and the types of, sorry, not the types of individuals, the types of offences which should be debarred from that initial placement within the female estate. In order for me to affect that operationally, I need to develop a standing operating procedure. That takes time because it needs to consider a range of factors around both the admission process, and we're going through, obviously, a detailed piece of work with our partners around the information that we receive on admission, so that will inform that standard operating procedure. Once I have that standard operating procedure developed, then we will implement that, and that should give a more nuanced position with regards to affecting the intention of the Cabinet Secretary's full statement, as opposed to the blanket approach that we have to take, which is a preventative measure. I think the other thing is that each individual will undergo a case conference as immediately as we can. So normally we try and pull a multidisciplinary case conference together on an individual, both at the point of admission, where we know that they are a transgender individual, but also the following day to try and gather as much information as possible. And clearly, where there are circumstances that arise where we think or consider that that individual does not fall within that threshold, then we can assess, again, using all of the information available to us, the best location for that individual, given the needs of the individual and the risks both to themselves and to others.
Okay. And I think what I'm trying to get at, does the individual have the right to appeal where they've been sent?
So as in any decision that's taken against an individual, taken on an individual in custody, there are always rights of appeal. So we have a complaints process. They can go to the complaints ombudsman. Clearly, there is the opportunity for judicial review as well. So there are a number of different avenues as well as writing to their local MSP, whereby they can appeal it. So there are mechanisms in place which will allow people to challenge the decisions that we take.
And just finally, for clarification, that you talked about setting up the operating procedure to do this. In the interim period, what would happen to a newly remanded or convicted transgender prisoner? Would they go to an establishment of their birth gender, or they would in that period?
Yes, absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you, convener. Okay, thanks very much indeed. Pauline McNeill, I'll bring you in now.
Thank you. Good morning. I suppose the key question is how do we move forward, but I just want to try and understand how we got to this point, because I think it's important, because I think a lot of things went wrong. Could I start with the Cabinet Secretary? Now, I haven't raised this directly with you. I have raised it with other ministers, and I have raised it with the SPS. I expressed my concern when the case of Katie Delatowski was live, and I'm just wondering why then ministers didn't raise it with the SPS before now, given we've heard in answer to Russell Findlay that the phone was lifted by your officials to the Scottish Prison Service. And I ask you that question because as Cabinet Secretary, I'm sure you're aware of the profile of women offenders. So the Macmillan research, I mean, just to pull out one statistic, 85% of women have reported adult sexual physical abuse. I'm sure you know all this. So my first question is, why didn't ministers raise this before now? I mean, there's a policy that's been in since 2014. It's been into the current day. And just to quote Rona Hodgkiss for completion, I mean, she's been vocal well before these decisions in saying that it's always an issue to have trans women with female prisoners, and the presence of a male-bodied person among vulnerable women causes them distress and consternation. So, given what you've said, do you think it's time to change the balance then of the policy, and were you aware that women's groups were not consulted in the design of this policy?
The design of the policy obviously was 2014. It remains relatively uncontentious for most of that period. I, as I've said already, do have confidence in the system that's there, and that is notwithstanding the changes which I announced. I think those changes, those policies, were ones which were pretty consistent with what the prison service does already. So I do have confidence in...
But that's not... With respect, that's not... I'm not asking... I know you have confidence. I'm asking you directly, were you aware that in the development of... Did anyone tell you that when the policy was developed, that women's groups were not consulted?
I think I was not in post at that time. Theresa Metters will know far better than me. However, you mentioned a governor in particular and her concerns. I've talked to other governors, not least the current chief executive of the prison service, who don't share the same views as that governor that you mentioned, who have got lengthy experience of dealing with transgender prisoners, and I do tend to rely on the advice that they provide because I think they are the experts in this area.
Sorry, I'm not trying to be difficult with you, but I know you keep relying on the same... I'm really trying to get to the bottom of this. As a Cabinet Secretary for Justice, I mean, would it concern you if you thought we had a policy in place since 2014 and women have been raising concerns, women's groups have been... that they weren't consulted? Does that concern you? And would you want going forward to make sure that that changes?
I do know that the policy, which I can speak to because I'm involved in this current process, at least as a Cabinet Secretary, the review that's taking place is consulting with people. It's consulting in particular with female prisoners, which is very important, and other interest groups. So I can't speak to that. I wasn't in this post in 2014. I do think it's important to have...
So you weren't aware then? I'm not trying to give you a trick question.
No, I've heard
you
weren't
aware.
I've heard it
that
said
women's
before
groups
that other people
not
have said
consulted.
That.
Okay.
I think it's actually been said in the chamber before. So, yes, I was aware of that. What I am concerned about, because I'm now in post, is that the current review of the policy does take into account the most important groups, and I think in that relation, the views of women prisoners in particular are very important. But I have to say that it's the prison service has undertaken that review, including the consultations, and it may be you want to hear from the person in charge of that review.
Yeah, I do in a minute. Sorry, I'm really just trying to get some clarity. I mean, that's all I'm trying to do. But would you agree, Cabinet Secretary, that in balancing the rights of everyone here, and I do note what you said and the importance of balancing the rights of trans people too, that what Rona Hodgkiss is talking about isn't that women might be at risk. What she's talking about is the privacy and dignity of women in prison is also important, and I wondered if you just agreed with that.
I've heard other governors say otherwise, that they think the privacy and dignity of women in prison can be accommodated within the way that they deal with transgender prisoners. And I have confidence in that view, but of course, it is something which is subject to the current review.
Thank you very much. Could I ask Theresa Medhurst, it's a similar, trying to get to the bottom, I know you weren't Governor for the whole of the period, so you probably heard the interview of a former prisoner who said that my whole time in prison, I was in constant high alert. My nerves were frazzled with fear and the incredibly violent men were walking around the communal shower area naked and sometimes, sorry for the language, clearly aroused. Myself and other women were in cubicles, but with only a curtain to protect us. I was shaking with fear. Now, I did raise this with the Deputy Governor. I have to confess I was shocked at the defence of the policy at the time. So if there's going to be change, I have to say I will welcome that. What's your view about this? I mean, I was told women, this is not true. First of all, I was told not true. And secondly, I was told that women are not at any risk and that there's separate showering arrangements. But that doesn't seem to bear out the testimony of women prisoners.
So if I can just say that in all our prisons across the estate, and clearly we have a range of different type of high-risk individuals who are in our custody. In any prison on any day, there are always protocols around how people are dressed when they come out of their cellular areas. So how they are dressed has got to be of a standard that's acceptable, because we have mixed gender staff groups across, again, all our prisons. So it's not appropriate for people to be wandering about in a communal area, either partially or fully unclothed, which is probably why there was some surprise at the claims that were made. And I'm not saying that person didn't experience that. I would be surprised as well. Because the other thing is that our communal areas also have cameras. So we have CCTV and we have access to CCTV. And I would have to say that for someone to be in that state of fear for the length of time would be very shocking to me, and I would be very concerned about that. But what I would be, again, also surprised about is that staff weren't aware of that, because staff are incredibly experienced in the relationships they have, particularly with women. They are always looking out for vulnerabilities, for changes in behaviour, for changes in relationships. There is a very well-established protocol that ensures that where there are issues arising that require to be dealt with or challenged, then staff will do so, and they will do so in a very firm manner. But equally,
so you seem to be questioning this, and I just point to the statement that Rona Hodgkiss made. She also says, so we've got a former governor of Cordon Vale who says, it's always the initiative of trans women with female prisoners and the presence of male-bodied persons. So it's not just one prisoner. So do you accept what Rona Hodgkiss has said?
I have governed the same establishment that Rona's governed. And in my experience, what happens is that particularly when we have an individual who is in custody for the first time, there are very clear protocols and restrictions placed around that individual, and there is very clear testing around how the relationships are developed between that and trans
individual.
So this
is not true. I mean, this is the problem I'm finding every time. It's the same with your deputy. Every time I ask a question, I get this management speak. I'm trying to get some clarity. Is Rona Hodgkiss, who's been the governor of Cordon Vale, I mean, is that fair? Is it a fair assessment
if that's Rona's,
but it's not yours.
If that's Rona's assessment, then clearly, and if she's, you know, she has that, she has evidence to back that up, then of course I would want and welcome her input.
It's not your experience.
But it wasn't my experience. My experience, the woman, we had a trans woman, and the women were incredibly supportive of her.
Sure.
They were very curious about her, and they were incredibly understanding. So my experience is different.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay, thanks very much. Thank you. So I'm just going to move on to Colette Stevenson, and then I'll bring in Katie Clark.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning. I wanted to look at the lessons learned review that's currently underway at the moment. And have you considered at all looking at other countries out with the UK in terms of good practice when it comes to the treatment of transgender prisoners as well as other vulnerable prisoners within the prison estates?
Do you want me to answer? So as part of the current review, there has been extensive consideration of other jurisdictions, obviously HMPPS, who are closest to us, but also from Canada and from New Zealand as well. We also have considered both research and policy or research and evidence that's available from across the globe, so that that does inform good practice. But I think what's also important is that there are cultural differences between ourselves and other jurisdictions. So I think it's really important that we pay attention to the views and perspectives of interest groups, I think, as Ms Mackay mentioned earlier, and Ms McNeill, but interest groups and the general public as well. So there's been a public consultation as part of that review. So we will pull together all of that, have pulled together all of that evidence, as well as the voices of our staff and those in our care, both non-transgender individuals as well as transgender.
Okay, thanks. And just on that, so see the policy in its current format. Does it meet with the standards of OPCAT as well?
I'm afraid I'm not sure I've got the answer to that question.
In terms of, the in Prisons Inspectorate are part of the MPM, which is responsible for overseeing the implementation of OPCAT, and they do inspection and monitoring of our prisons in line with OPCAT.
And are they fairly comfortable with the current policy in its current format at the moment, Inspectorate?
It's not been raised. It's not been raised with me. Certainly, I don't know with Teresa at all.
The Inspectorate have obviously access to all of our policies. They visit all of our prisons and can do so at any time. And a number of our prisons now do have transgender individuals within their care, and there has been nothing that has been raised with us around the current policy or practice.
And they would raise that on a regular basis with each prison estate if there was an issue there, yeah?
That would come through either through the independent prison monitors who are allocated to each prison, if they considered that there was any practice or issue that required to be raised. Equally, it comes through the inspection reports, which are published a few months after each inspection.
Can I just quickly, and I'll finish there, sorry. Will you be consulting with the inspectorate and each of the monitors that are coming into the prisons on the review and seeking feedback from them based on...
So the review has sought the views of a wide range of not only public sector organisations but third sector organisations and interest groups as well, which would include the inspectorate, yes.
Okay, thank you. Thanks very much.
Okay, thanks very much. And I bring in Katie Clark, followed by Jamie Green.
Thank you very much. And if I can go back to the lessons learned review and what actually happened on the 24th and 25th of January. Now, the facts, as we understand it, are that when the individual was initially charged, when the offences took place, they were a man, but thereafter, they hadn't self-defined as a woman at that point, but thereafter they self-defined as a woman. That's our understanding of the position. You say that, that in terms of the review, that the 2014 policy was adhered to. That's the outcome of the review. We've obviously not seen the full lessons learned review. We've just seen the summary, but that's the summary that the policy was adhered to. But I think you're also saying that the multidisciplinary assessment hadn't taken place as of 24th January, 25th, 25th January, is that correct? So that's our understanding of the position. So what we don't understand is why the individual was not transferred to Berlini and held in segregation there pending the multidisciplinary risk assessment.
So I think Cabinet Secretary made reference in his introduction about our inability to discuss individual cases, and that would apply in this case. What I would say to you is that
Can I interject? I mean, you are an experienced witness. You have appeared in front of this committee on many occasions. Mm-hmm. We do need answers. Mm-hmm. I'm not asking you to talk about individuals. I'm asking... You're saying the policy was adhered to. So I'm asking you, given the facts as we mm-hmm. understand them, and I think you've agreed to the facts, I think we accept, we all agree the facts, mm-hmm. given the facts as they were, as on the 24th and 25th January, given that situation, we don't need to talk mm-hmm. about the individual, why was that person not transferred into the male estate and held in segregation there pending the multidisciplinary risk assessment?
So that's what I'm trying to explain, Ms Clark. So... when an individual is a decision or an outcome is made at court, that individual is then passed on to GUAMI. GUAMI, as our contractor, will try and ensure that where possible, all relevant information is provided to us as a prison service. And the prison service then are required to make a judgment based on that information. If you look at the policy, what the policy says is that where an individual identifies in a social gender, then consideration is given to where that individual is located. Our processes and the way that we manage individuals mean that we have to assess and determine where best to undertake those assessments. But that safest place to undertake those assessments is an operational decision, and an operational decision was taken on the placement of that individual.
So are you telling us that the policy from 2014 mm-hmm. has been irrespective of whether a multidisciplinary risk assessment has taken place, an operational decision is taken on the basis of how the individual defines themselves at that point?
The factors that we look at are not just about, and that comes through all of the information that we provide, it's not just about that individual. That individual identifies in whichever social gender they choose to do so. It is one factor, but it is... as it states in the policy, it is something which does need to be considered. There, you also have to look at safety. And we have, I mentioned earlier, so we have a range of different measures that we can put in place, which includes special security measures, so protecting people by putting in limitations over what they can and cannot do. The other way that we can do that is by placing them in segregation and identifying the most suitable segregation point for that individual. That those are decisions that we take on a day and daily basis, and they will always have to be taken in advance of a multidisciplinary case conference, because at the time of admission, there is no time for that case conference to take place. Because what you require to have, medical input, you require to have individual, if there are social work representatives that require to be there, if the individual, if they are transgender, have been working, for example, with medical experts such as the Sandyford Clinic, you might ask for representation. All of that takes time. So at the point of admission, we will not have, and we always have, extremely limited information. What people do at that point is make a best case decision based on the information they have.
And what factors would be taken into account? Because we know on this occasion, it was not somebody that had lived as a woman for many years, because at the time of the offence, they hadn't self-defined. At some point during the legal process, did their status change? Do you know that? Was that a fact that was available at the time? And was the offence taken into account and the conviction taken into account in the operational decision that was taken. Now, I'm not asking you to focus on the individual.
Okay.
I'm asking you to focus on how these issues are dealt with and what factors would be taken into account, so, given you haven't got all the facts, mm-hmm. you haven't had the multidisciplinary assessment.
Absolutely. So what would be taken into account would be any information that we would have from the court. And again, that information would be limited. And any information that we had on the individual, all of that would be factored in to the decision that's made. But it is almost an immediate decision. And people weigh up the different elements of the... it's not an algorithmic approach, but they weigh up every element of information they have and reach what they consider to be the best decision given the circumstances.
And I'm not asking you to refer to individuals, but at what level would that decision be taken? Who would it be taken by?
Sometimes,
what level within the service?
So sometimes decisions will be taken by individual establishments and senior leaders within those establishments. On occasions, they may ask for support from headquarters and from more senior people, and that might also include input from others who have expertise.
And I'm not asking you to identify individuals, but at what level was this decision taken?
This was a decision that was taken in conjunction with headquarters.
OK. In terms of the lesson learned review, I know that, I mean, this policy has been under review, the 2014 policy, for a number of years, and you've gone through a very quick lesson learned review in relation to this particular incident. Are there recommendations that have been identified in the lessons learned review that were not identified in all the review work that's been happening all over the last few years in relation to the 2014 policy?
So the review for the 2014 policy was committed to in 2019, mm-hmm. and there was some early scoping work undertaken at that time. However, then the pandemic hit, and it was only in 2021 that we were able to create the capacity to commence the review. I know that there have been concerns raised about how long the review has taken, but there have been...
And we haven't got a lot of time, maybe you could answer the question, which is whether the recommendations identified in this lessons learned review that weren't recognised in that very long process.
So the formulation of the recommendations from the review are still underway, and the work that we've undertaken as part of this will be used to inform that process.
And given the witnesses have said they're not aware of concerns that have been raised before, can I just very briefly ask whether they're aware of some concerns that are currently being raised?
Very final question, because there are other members
waiting
to come in.
So there's three issues that I'd like to put to you that there's concerns being raised. The first is that in relation to individuals that are currently in the estate, we understand that individuals are no longer going to be moved. Where there's fresh charges, if those fresh charges are of a violent or sexual nature, whether that is, whether that's against boys or men or girls or women, what approach will be taken? We're having concerns as politicians raise with us in relation to searches. For example, women prison officers being asked to conduct searches on individuals with male genitalia, and indeed male prison officers being asked to conduct searches on trans men with female genitalia. And also we're having concerns raised about the safety of trans men on the estate and the duties of care that you have when trans men are being kept in the male estate. Are you aware of those concerns, and will you either today or indeed thereafter get back to us on these issues, given that you're saying that you're not aware, and it's people within the system that are raising those concerns with us? Are those concerns that you're aware of?
So there are some of those concerns that I'm aware of, but I am more than happy for those concerns for us to respond back to you on them, Ms Clark.
Thank you.
Because some of them I'm not aware of.
OK, thank you.
OK, thank you. Jamie Green.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I'll open my line of questioning with the, I guess, some consensus with what the Cabinet Secretary said, that I think we do need to be careful not to stigmatise an entire community for the actions of a small group within that community, but we are perfectly entitled, and it's entirely appropriate to ask specific questions about what's happened, given the very understandable public interest in it. I might be a little bit more just simple and direct to my line of questions in the hope that we get through these more easily. Can I just ask quite straightforwardly, who made the decision? Who made the decision to house Isla Bryson in the female estate?
That decision, as I said earlier, was taken by headquarters.
Whose headquarters? Is that a person or is that a chain of command?
I'm really not at liberty to say. I mean, it's normally there are processes locally and processes nationally, and people will seek advice through their channels into headquarters, and that's what was done on this occasion.
Somebody must have signed this decision off.
Well, ultimately, I think, Mr Green, the position is that I'm accountable for all decisions within the organisation, so can see me.
OK, so the buck rests at the top.
Absolutely.
I understand that. Yeah. Can I ask, therefore, given the current policy and any future changes, that individual is no longer in that location. We know that. Were you effectively overruled by Scottish ministers on the decision that you ultimately were in charge of?
No, absolutely not.
Can I ask, at what point in that decision-making process did it ever seem appropriate to house a rapist in the women's estate, and has that ever happened before?
Has it? So if I come to the second point first, to be honest with you, I'm not aware of a similar case, but I would need to check that, and I'd need to come back to you. And on the first point, sorry, could you reiterate the first point again?
Just as a wider point, as we look to move forward and offer some clarity to the public around this, at what point did it ever feel or be deemed appropriate to house someone who had been convicted of the crime of rape, to house them at any stage in this proceedings in the women's prison estate? Why in anyone's logical thinking would that ever be appropriate?
So I understand the public concerns, and I understand why you've raised that question. In my last responses to Ms Clark, I think what I tried to set out was that there are a really complex set of issues that are required to be considered, both in relation to the risks that someone may pose, the risks to themselves, the needs of individuals, the needs of others, and the rights of individuals and the rights of others. So it's not a simple process. And at the point of time when someone is making a decision on the location of an individual, they will have extremely limited information and make the best decision at that time, given both the circumstances and our policy position.
But that in itself is a problem. What do you mean limited information? Surely you should have access to fulsome quantities of information about that individual. First of all, that person's gone through quite a lengthy court case, undoubtedly with an element of public interest in it. At what point does the nature of the crime itself for which they've been convicted become a primary factor in that decision-making? Because clearly it sounds in this case it wasn't.
So there are circumstances, if I can talk generally, there are circumstances whereby people are charged with offences, where they may be convicted of offences, where they can be bailed for offences, and where at the point that they then come to court, they come to us with little or no information. So it's not a case of there is a lot of information that's available to the SPS, and that's been recognised in the lessons learned, and that's why we're undertaking a review and speaking to our colleagues in Police Scotland, Crown and Prosecution Service, and also in the Court Service, because there may be more information that they have, but it doesn't come through to us at the time. So there is something around both the sharing of information, and that's why we're developing a memorandum of understanding, but also the way that is communicated that could be improved on, and that's why we're in discussions with partners.
So the current situation is that no transgender offender who has been convicted of a crime of violence or sexual violence against women or girls, I presume other types of violence and domestic abuse, will currently or ever be held in the female estate. Is that something you can give assurances of, or is this just a temporary measure?
So the definition that the Cabinet Secretary, the intent that the Cabinet Secretary announced on the 29th of January has been, we've actually taken a more precautionary measure at the moment.
His directive, though?
That, yes.
Under ministerial directive?
Yes, okay. Under ministerial directive, that no one who is convicted of violence against women, and that's in the broadest sense, will be admitted to a female prison when they're newly convicted. And therefore, at the moment, the measures that I have taken until we develop a standard operating procedure is that anyone who comes into custody from now on will be allocated to an establishment that is commensurate with their birth gender, okay, as opposed to their social gender.
Yeah, I understand that. I don't think that really answers the question. I maybe ask the Cabinet Secretary directly then. Is this just a temporary measure, or will this become a permanent feature of how the process works?
I think you've heard this is a lessons learned review on the particular case that's been mentioned, and that's going to feed into the larger review. So the larger review will determine how we go forward. But just to restate the fact that what was carried out, the policy carried out by the prison service was, first and foremost, to ensure the safety of all prisoners. They've had a very good track record of making sure that's the case. So if somebody was admitted to an otherwise female prison, and it's worth bearing in mind we have both women and men in many of our prisons, if they were admitted to that prison, then they were held in segregation, so they minimised the risk to other prisoners and to staff. So on top of that, we provided the additional direction, which you just mentioned, to make sure that in the first instance people go to a substantially male or a male estate, part of the male estate. So whether it is, I should say there's an exception to that, which we stipulated to the prison service, which was any case where they felt it was imperative that that was not the case, they had to get ministerial approval, which is exactly the same situation as is provided in other jurisdictions like England and Wales. So that's the current situation, but there is the overarching review which will take these things forward.
Understood. And can I ask Ms. Medhurst, are there currently any trans women prisoners in the women's state who have been convicted of crimes of violence against women?
I'm sorry, I'm really struggling at the moment. I think my answer would be not the case, and I'm looking at Neil for some help here, because I've been through a number of... obviously, we're going through the reviews at the moment. Mm-hmm. So my answer would be no,
there,
I don't...
There are
I
only
don't.
Five in total, so you must know.
Well, yes, then that would be the case, then.
Our understanding is there's no one, not currently any trans females in the female estate who have live convictions for violence against women.
So there are none, is the answer. Yeah. Okay, that's reassuring. And finally, what effect does the possession of a GRC have on your decision making? Because I think there's still a little bit of ambiguity as to what that decision-making process looks and feels like. I know you spoke about it, and I understand much of the rationale that you go through, and I know you've been doing this for a very long time, and the actions of prison staff are to be commended for the way that they handle these sensitive issues. And that's all a matter of public record, but it is still unclear as to how you go about those decisions, and I'm quite intrigued as to what effect the position of a legal document such as the GRC would have on your decision-making, versus someone who simply declares in a different way without perhaps that legal recognition that others may have. And that does also include those who've perhaps gone through some form of transition as well.
So the position with regards to a gender recognition certificate is that that would be considered as a factor, important factor, but it would be considered as a factor during the multidisciplinary case conference, and taken into account when a decision is reached, both on the management plan for the individual as well as the location. But it wouldn't necessarily override other risk factors that were more compelling.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
OK, thanks very much. I think, Rona Mackay, you maybe have a supplementary to this line of question.
Conscious of time. I just wondered, newly remanded prisoners who go to establishment of their birth gender, would they be segregated as a matter of course, or could they be segregated if they requested it? I'm thinking in terms of their human rights and they haven't been convicted of anything.
And that's something that is of concern, because clearly we don't want to disproportionately segregate people who are trans individuals, either women, trans women or trans men. So that's where trying to develop a standard operating procedure, looking at the memorandum of understanding with other justice partners to gather as much information as we can, will help inform that decision. But equally, we need to take on board the wishes of the individual and assess how comfortable they feel in their environment and whether or not there are additional protections that we need to provide, both in respect of the location. So somebody going in, for example, to somewhere like Edinburgh Prison, which is a large establishment with varying parts of the estate held over for, you know, remand prisoners, for sex offenders, for short-term prisoners. There may be a decision taken not to, for example, put them in with other remand prisoners if it's felt that they would be safer somewhere else. Mm-hmm. So each establishment will need to operationalise the standard operating procedure and look at each individual case on its own merits.
I mean, their wishes would be taken into account.
Absolutely.
If they requested something. Thank
yes.
you. That's fine.
Thanks very much. Fulton McGregor, would you like to come in?
Morning, panel. I was actually going to ask about the effect of a GRC, but you've covered that in your response to Jamie Green. So I've only got one other question, and that is, you'll obviously be aware that the gender recognition bill passed through Parliament weeks before this situation came to light. Can I ask if the process... I know the bill's not come into law because of the current situation with the UK government, but did the process of that bill and the passage of that bill have any impact on the decisions around the situation that's led us here today?
So my understanding is that in the work that we've been conducting in relation to both the review and following the progress of the bill, that the position on the gender recognition certificate would not substantially change. There would be no effect on us. And therefore we could still fulfil our obligations in the way that we have been doing, looking at each individual case and assessing that as one element in relation to balancing risk, needs and rights. Whether or not there are any further considerations that need to be taken into account, given the position that the Cabinet Secretary has stipulated around those individuals who have convictions of violence against women, we still need to work that through.
Okay. Thanks very much. We're just about coming up to time, but I think in recognition of the importance and interest in this issue, I'm happy to bring in couple more final questions, and I'll start with Russell Finlay, and then I'll bring in Pauline McLean. I know you've got a question you'd like to ask.
Thank
Russell.
You, Convener. Yeah, I'd like to ask about the SPS review, which is a work in progress and was initially, I think, due to be published last summer. It's a two-pronged question. Would there be any value, or are you considering perhaps publishing this as a draft document initially in order to give various bodies the chance to feedback and respond to it, or whether it will be published as a final work? And finally, is there, given it's already been delayed, will it be further delayed until the new First Minister is in place? Will that have any bearing on it?
Certainly hadn't anticipated there being a delay because of a change in the First Minister. There is likely to be a further delay because of the additional work we're now having to apply because of the lessons learned and the additional measures that we're now putting in place. With regards to the process for publication, there have been no final decisions given the nature of the public interest, although we have tried as far as possible to undertake an extensive consultation. Clearly, I understand that there is a high degree of interest in our new policy, so we will still need to work through what that looks like and how best to present it. And that will include, obviously, understanding how the Cabinet Secretary wants that process to be applied as well.
And what's your latest estimate of when it might be published?
To be honest, it's really difficult to give you anything that's definitive. I would like it to be done as soon as practicable, but even the standard operating procedure that we have been working on is not going to be developed as quickly as I would have hoped, and that's because there are other partners that are involved in processing that.
Is this year likely?
I would be very disappointed, Mr. Finlay, if it wasn't definitely this year, but sooner rather than later.
Okay, thank you.
And finally, Pauline McNeill.
Thank you. Hopefully this is a straightforward question. It's just a follow-on from Katie Clark's about who made the decision and all that. I'm not trying to get you to say who made it, but what I didn't understand was, so we've got a segregated unit in Berlinney for sex offenders, and presumably I've actually been in the cells where there's, you know, individual, surely solitary confinement there. So why the decision maker, why did they not just hold them in the segregated units within the estate for assessment? That's a really important question to answer now or to commit at some point. And is the problem the 2014 policy is a self-ID policy, so you didn't have a choice? I think this is really important to get to the bottom of, because if we want to move on from it and there are to be genuine lessons learned, we need to know why. Because that seems like an obvious, sensible question. Any member of the public would ask that. Well, why did that prisoner need to go to Cotton Vale for assessment to be segregated? So we've heard all that, you know, there was no risk to women, but it could have been segregated somewhere else. So my question's a clear question. Why did the decision maker not hold Isla Bryson in another part of the male estate until a decision, albeit a decision I might not have liked, but albeit a decision? Why not?
Given circumstances, given the information, the decision, so segregation was clearly a factor in the decision, but the segregation unit that was used was the segregation unit at Cotton Vale, and that was given all of the information that was known at that time.
Did you mean information because they had self-ID'd, that information? Can we be clear about this?
The policy is very clear, Ms. McNeill, about...
But can you be clear with
social,
me?
Right. About social gender and identification, right, of social gender.
So that's the reason.
And whilst it's not an automatic right to be in the female estate, it is one factor that will be considered. And on the basis of the information...
Sorry, that does not make any sense. If it's one factor, is it fair to say the decision maker then could have said, OK, I've looked at that, this person has self-identified as a woman. The decision maker could then have, under the policy, said, I'm going to segregate that person in Berlinney until we decide where the person's going to go. Could that have been a decision then, or not?
That could have been a decision.
Right, but the decision maker chose not to do that.
Correct.
Do you know why?
Because the decision maker, as with all decisions that are operational, looks at the information that they have, the information that they don't have, and they make the best decision given the information that they have.
Right, and they check this with headquarters.
To protect both other people and the individual, they make the best decision that they can based on the, either the information they have, but also knowing and understanding the information.
But what would
have
been, I know what you're saying, but given headquarters signed this off, what would have been the risk if they had been segregated? Where's the risk? There's no risk. Surely there's no risk. If you segregate, I don't know if there's a segregated unit in Greenock, but I know there is in Berlinney. What would have been the risk?
I think it's very difficult from an operational perspective to second guess a decision that somebody's taken.
So, you've already told the committee that it was signed off by headquarters, so nobody second guessed. You know, which is it? You gave evidence to this committee saying that it was signed off by headquarters. Am I right?
How
is it second guessed?
You make a decision. What I'm saying is, us sitting here today, several weeks down the line, clearly knowing and understanding more about the individual, more about
in
the
hindsight.
Case.
You're saying in hindsight.
That's what I meant.
Sorry. Okay. I just thought. The three second guess that you obviously, in hindsight, you're saying in hindsight, knowing what we all know now, and thank you for that.
Appreciate it. Okay. Thank you very much. And on that note, I'm going to bring this session to a close. Thank you very much to all our witnesses for attending this morning's meeting. We'll now have a short suspension just to allow for a changeover of officials. Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone. So our next agenda item is oral evidence on a motion to annul the following negative instrument, the Parole Board Scotland Rules of 2022, that's SSI 2022 number 385, and I refer members to paper 2. And I welcome back to the meeting the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans and his officials, Ms Sandra Wallace, Parole Policy Manager, and Mr Nicholas Duffy, Senior Principal Legal Officer, who is joining us online. So I'd like to just invite Jamie Green to speak to and move his motion.
Thank you, Convener. Can I also thank the clerks of the committee for scheduling this into today's meeting. I know we have a very, very busy agenda today, as proceedings have already shown. Can I also thank the Cabinet Secretary and his officials for attending what would have hitherto been an unnecessary appearance, but nonetheless an important one. I will be honest, a lot of what I have already said around the issue is a matter of public record and is in the official report, so I won't repeat all of that. And I did give some serious consideration to my motion today to annul the SSI that we were presented with prior to the recess. And it wasn't a decision I took lightly. In fact, it's the first time I've done it in my 7.5 years in this Parliament. But I did feel on this issue it was entirely appropriate and would be beneficial to the committee. There is very little in the original SSI with regards to parole board rules that I disagree with. There are some very sensible changes in the SSI, but there are two reasons why I wanted to bring it back to the committee for debate, and I'm looking forward to hearing members' contributions on it. The first is that I personally believe that it is a missed opportunity by the government to change parole board rules to the benefit of the victims of crime and the way that some practices are managed. And the second reason is that it was my only method of bringing this back to the chamber. Apologies. Just carry on. Okay. We're letting light into the room, finally.
Maybe just pause for a meeting second. For a moment, just to...
Okay. Thank you.
Back to you, Jamie.
I know the Cabinet Secretary has a panic button under the desk there, but I didn't realise it did that. So I want to get into the main detail of my motion to annul. I think what it also has done, and I'm grateful to the Parole Board themselves for writing to the committee with quite a robust and informative response. And can I thank John Watt, the chairperson of the Parole Board for that commentary. I think had I not actually raised this motion, we would not have received that communication. So by its very nature, I believe that vindicates my position in bringing this back to the committee. I won't go through all of the elements of the Parole Board Scotland Rules 2022 SSI, but I would like to make the point that because it was presented to us as a negative instrument, the only option available to me was to put forward a motion to annul. There is no opportunity, as is the case of other pieces of secondary legislation, to have a proper debate ahead of making that decision, or indeed to amend it in any way. There is no such mechanism available to us. And I think on the sorts of issues that we're looking at today, as important as they are, the Parliament and indeed the way in which government brings forward secondary legislation might want to reflect on that to give... We're often passing primary legislation in this place with promises that secondary legislation is very well scrutinised. Well, it isn't. And I think the fact that I have to go through this process to scrutinise it and to take evidence on it and get more information on it and hear what the Cabinet Secretary and the Director has to say, I think is evidence that the current process is not always fit for purpose. I only want to look at a few specific issues that I raised in my comments at the last meeting. And therefore reflect on the responses given by the Parole Board. And the first is around that of what we call Suzanne's Law. And I should declare an interest in that members and the Cabinet Secretary will be aware that I have completed a consultation on a proposal for a Members Bill. And it is very relevant to today's discussion because much of the content of the pro-board rules which the government is seeking to amend through the statutory instrument would have a direct effect on what the potential content of my bill would look like, or indeed the admissibility of some of the elements of my own bill. So I do have a declared interest, and that's why it is important to me to get to the root of some of these issues. I raised the issue of the so-called Suzanne's Law. As we may know, Suzanne's Law is effectively a process by which an individual cannot be released from custody or imprisonment if they have failed to disclose where a victim's remains have been disposed of prior to that release. And we all know the tragic incident that to which that eponymous law relates. And of course, as always, our thoughts are with the victim's family in this case. But like many of these so-called laws, there is a victim, and it is often a female victim of violence or abuse. We understand that the historic position of the Scottish Government was that they would be sympathetic to the introduction of some form of Suzanne's Law where technically possible. And that's something that I think I welcomed, and other victims and victims' organisations welcomed at the time. It seems to be that the changes made in the SSI that was presented to us seem to offer a version of that. But I think it's quite clear from the response we had last week from the Pro Board that is not the case. The Pro Board state that they, whilst in black and white, state that they will now, they may take into account the failure to reveal the whereabouts of a victim. It will be a factor in that decision making, but I presume that is something that they would have done anyway, or the question that I pose is that a new factor? Therefore, is this a substantive change in the decision making process? But they then refer to the point that it is almost irrelevant anyway, because the primary test of whether someone should be released is related to the Prisoner and Criminal Proceedings Scotland Act 1993, which states that the test is if the board is satisfied, and I quote, if the board is satisfied that it is no longer necessary for the protection of the public that the prisoner should be confined. And if the answer to that question is it is no longer necessary, then the prisoner is released. And that is the prime consideration. All other factors are certainly part of that decision-making process. But they do make it clear that the failure to disclose the whereabouts of a body can only be considered in the context of that overall assessment of risk, i.e. risk to the public. So there is an argument that it would be virtually impossible to implement Suzanne's Law meaningfully in any shape or form under these regulations without a substantive change to the 1993 Act. The Pro Board themselves believe that this would require amendment of the 93 Act to bring this policy change into force. Whilst it doesn't form part of this instrument, the question I would pose, the Cabinet Secretary could respond to, is if the government is willing to review the 93 Act in respect of this, if such a change could be made, and if they are not minded to do so, why not? I understand the Pro Board also make reference to their role in all of this, that if the scenario where a prisoner refuses to reveal the location of a victim, that the automatic barring of release would in some way negate the role of the Pro Board in any decision making, because that would be a primary factor first and everything else second. They also observe that this may not be ECHR compliant, and I'm sure that will be used as a defence of such a change. But I guess what I'm trying to probe here is what is the government's current position, because I don't know. And I know historic Justice Secretaries were a little bit more forthcoming with this, and I hope that the government will understand why I think this is an important change. Because if it becomes apparent that the government are not willing to or unable to, for legal reasons, progress a policy change like this, then naturally it will remain on as a part of my forthcoming bill as I go on to drafting stage. But if I think that the government or the government is willing to work with me on any changes, then it could easily be removed from that proposition. I want to move on to another issue, and that's the victim notification scheme. One of the changes in the regulation we were asked to look at is around information that's given to those who sign up to the scheme. The Pro Board makes, I think, a valid claim about the issue of informing those who signed up to Part 1 of the VNS not receiving certain types of information that they do not necessarily want. We have had evidence from victim support organisations who believe that who have been quite explicit that not all victims want information about what is coming next. But there are many who do, and there are many who feel that they are being let down by the current process, and I think it's important to get that on the record. I don't necessarily disagree with the board and the change that it's making. I understand that wider changes to the VNS are outside the remit of this instrument, but I would like an update from the government as to what potential changes to the VNS would make it a much more compassionate, informative and trauma-informed service than it is at the moment, because clearly it is failing many victims of crime. The other substantive issue that was raised in proceedings and responded to by the Pro Board is that of victim observations and parole hearings. I think actually in yesterday's excellent debate in the chamber that my colleague Russell Finlay brought around Victims Awareness Week, the issue around the BBC programme, which was broadcast around parole, which was a fascinating insight into decision-making in other parts of the UK. But one of the things that we do often hear is that lack of transparency in the parole system here in Scotland. And the victims that certainly we've spoken to as a committee, but also individually as members, is that they feel that they are very much excluded from the process. That even when they are able to observe the process, since many have had difficulties in observing the process, they feel that they are afforded little to no opportunity to have any meaningful participation. And I think it is important, I understand some of the defence comments made by the Pro Board around if you start inferring rights on a victim to not just observe but participate in a pro hearing, that does change the game somewhat, and I understand that. I think the quote is that the board operates as a court. If a victim was to present a statement to the tribunal, then that would dictate that the prisoner would be able to cross-examine the victim. I don't know how legally robust that assertion is, but it's something I would like to test. There is a wider point, though, and that's simply that many victims do tell us, whether we like it or not, that they do not feel that their needs and views are taken properly into account when parole hearings and decisions are being made. And that is a valid criticism, and I think that's something that we should be mindful of. I'm not necessarily stating that victims should be able to give oral statements in live proceedings at a parole hearing. That may not be suitable for all victims of crime, but certainly some form of meaningful participation that informs the decision-making, informs the board's decision, I think would be a step ahead of where we are than simply observing. Observing gives you absolutely no rights other than to sit there and listen and not participate. So I still think there is work to be done there. There are some other minor and I think technical issues that were raised by the Pro Board, of which I have no problem whatsoever. And as I said, there are other parts of the SSI which I don't have a problem with around the risk management plan, and I think others, members, talked about prisoner preparation and other issues that the Pro Board do respond to. And I understand that the VNS issue is that of a wider governmental review, not necessarily the remit of the Pro Board. So I just want to sum up by saying I'm not trying to be difficult by raising these issues today. There's nothing in the rule changes that I disagree with. I'll put that on the record. But what I hope this debate has done is given the opportunity to air some of these issues, something that we should have done or should have been able to have done before having to been asked to make a decision on the instrument itself. And I thank members for their forbearance. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you. And can I just confirm if you can move your motion?
Would it be possible to let members contribute first before I make that decision?
Yeah. If you want to move it, and then I'll ask Understood. You later if you're going to press or withdraw it.
Okay, I'll move it for now then. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And on that note, I'll invite the Cabinet Secretary to respond.
Thanks very much, Convener, and thanks for the chance to make a contribution in support of the Parole Board Scotland Rules 2022 and to debate the motion that's just been moved by Jamie Green. I understand that the committee had some concerns, we've heard that expressed, I think, by Jamie Green about the amount of time they've had to consider the rules. Before starting, I think it's important to be clear that this SSI was laid in December. It comes into force in April, and it therefore allows the full 40 days required by the Parliament for parliamentary consideration as to whether the committee wanted to consider this prior to that. It's not an issue that I have a say on. I'm sure that the committee will appreciate the need to provide the new rules of procedure for the Parole Board. The previous rules date from 2001, meaning they're over 20 years old, and they have in that time undergone multiple amendments, which has led to them becoming more complex and inaccessible. They are in need of change, and to make them as clear and understandable as they can be seems to be a sensible thing to do. The 2022 rules under discussion bring a new and simplified structure to the Parole Board's rules and align some common processes. For example, all oral hearings on parole cases will now follow the same procedure. They also introduce procedures to clarify existing practice and improve processes. They aim to provide the Parole Board with effective and transparent procedures that help with the smooth running of Parole Board business. If we were to annul these rules as proposed, that would mean that we would lose all the benefits included in them, such as avoiding re-traumatising victims. For example, the new rules, Rule 9 in brackets 2, allow a victim's statement to be withheld from the dossier given to the prisoner should they wish their views to remain private, and the Parole Board consider it should be treated as non-disclosure. That would be lost if this were to be annulled. The rules also ensure that victims are also given only the information they signed up to receive. Again, Mr Green addressed this point when they registered with the victim notification scheme. They also improve the process for prisoners, ensuring they're better prepared for a hearing, and provide a new procedure to allow the Parole Board to appoint a representative for prisoners if they lack the capacity to appoint one themselves. It's important to note the rules have been developed with the Parole Board to ensure they were workable and fit for purpose, and they also build on the consultation with the public carried out last year, and they reflect our engagement with other stakeholders, including, importantly, Victim Support Scotland, the Risk Management Authority and the Law Society for Scotland. And just to cover a couple of the points raised by Mr Green, first of all, in relation to the victim of the offence, where it's somebody that's been murdered, not being revealed. And I think within that, Jamie Green also asked whether we had any current proposals to change the law in that regard. I think that, importantly, criminal law already permits failure to disclose a body to be taken into account when sentencing. Existing criminal law contains an offence of defeating the ends of justice, and this can and has been used in cases where a murderer has failed to disclose the location of their victim, as it was in the Suzanne Pulley case when sentencing David Gilroy. The court can take into account all charges when sentencing to ensure a suitable sentence is imposed to account for all criminal conduct. The role of the Parole Board is to assess when a prisoner, having served the sentence handed down by the court, may be released without posing a risk to the community. And I think it's right that decisions on risk and release are made on a case-by-case basis by the independent Parole Board, who may take all relevant information into account. Denying parole to someone solely on the grounds of they are not revealing the location of a victim's body will, and Jamie Green mentioned this, may also create ACHR issues. For example, a proposal which required a prisoner to be held indefinitely until they provided certain information, notwithstanding that they may not know or remember the information in question, may not be compatible with the ECHR rights under Article 3. This is as the prohibition on inhuman or degrading treatment provided in Article 3 requires a life sentence to include safeguards which against indefinite detention without possibility of release. And the proposal also appears to be inconsistent with existing safeguards for human rights which form part of the sentencing and parole processes. It suggests that prisoners will be detailed for longer than the punishment part imposed by the court, with no possibility of parole due to the lack of cooperation. This may cause issues of arbitrary detention contrary to Article 5 ECHR and may interfere with the right to silence, which is protected by Article 6 ECHR. So it does touch on some fundamental human rights. And just to answer directly the point raised by Jamie Green, we have no plans, the government has no plans to change legislation in the way that he has suggested.
He's also mentioned, though, of course, his own victims' bill. And as I've said before, I'm more than happy to discuss this and other issues as part of that process. Finally, I think I think we perhaps covered the issues in relation to victim notification earlier on in the statement. But the Pro Board's indicated that they will prepare guidance for their members on the new rules before they come to force on the 1st of April 2023, unless, of course, Parliament votes to annul the rules. But for the reasons I mentioned, and a number of other reasons for which time prevents me from mentioning, I think it's important that these rules are passed, and I would therefore urge Mr Green to withdraw his motion to annul these rules. And if that's not the case, I would urge the members of the committee to oppose the motion. And with that, convener, my officials and I are happy to answer any questions the committee may have.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. So I'm now going to open it up for questions, and I'm going to firstly bring in Katie Clark, followed by Russell Finlay. Katie.
Thank you, convener. And I will keep my contribution relatively short. I don't have any objection to the rules that are being put forward by the Cabinet Secretary. However, I do welcome the motion to annul that's been put down by Jamie Green. As the committee discussed on the previous occasions, a number of us do feel that this is a missed opportunity. We would have liked the committee to have been involved in the discussion perhaps at an earlier stage, and we felt that we were coming to this quite late. And of course, the process and the procedure is that these rules are not something that we're able to amend as a parliament. So I welcome that the motion to annul has been submitted, because I don't actually have any objection to any of the rules that are being put before us. I don't think I would be minded to vote for Jamie Green's motion, but I do think it's given us the opportunity to highlight some of the issues. And indeed, as Jamie Green has said, we've, as a committee, been furnished with quite considerable further information, which is very useful. So I do think that there is a far wider debate that needs to take place about the role of victims, not just the meaningful role in the way that Jamie Green suggests, but also experience that victims have had for generations of lack of information and feeling excluded from the process and finding out issues, perhaps accidentally and at a far later stage than they would have wished. So I think collectively, I think as a parliament, we're aware of that. There was a debate yesterday in Parliament in relation to victims' rights. And therefore, whilst, as I say, I probably wouldn't be minded to vote for Jamie Green's motion, I think the fact that it's been put down as welcome, as he says, often this committee is looking at enabling legislation, often the Parliament is looking at enabling legislation, and we are asked to vote for legislation effectively on trust that the regulations that come thereafter will be acceptable, but there isn't really a proper process for scrutiny of that subordinate legislation. So I'm really speaking because I don't want to give the impression that time has been wasted by putting down this motion, because even if there isn't actually significant problems with the rules that are being presented, I think this is a missed opportunity, and I think it's important that this committee puts on record that we would want more done in relation to the issues that have been raised.
Thank you very much. Russell Finlay.
Yes, thank you very much. Now, I support Jamie Green's motion, and I agree with his comment and indeed Katie Clark's comments about this being a missed opportunity in relation to victim involvement, contribution in parole board hearings. But I've got nothing particular to add about that. My interest lies in Suzanne's Law. It's something that I've had an interest in for a number of years. I happen to have been a witness in a murder trial of Margaret Fleming, whose remains have never been recovered and whose two convicted killers have shown no signs of disclosing where they are. So it's something that I believe is such an appalling situation for families to live with, where killers exercise this ongoing power, if you like, and relentless re-traumatisation of families who would desperately like to have closure. Now, in December last year, I was aware of a BBC news report and other news reports about apparently Scottish Government bringing in Suzanne's Law. And the BBC report and I'll quote this, said, "A change to Scotland's parole rules could mean that killers are denied release if they do not say where and how they dispose of victims' remains." And frankly, I was delighted. It seemed like good news. It sounded like what all these families and various campaigners have been calling for was coming to pass. However, when we saw the SSI, it became apparent that the content of the SSI fell significantly short of the publicity that had been generated by it. And that's no criticism of the BBC or other media. I think they were presented in a certain way. When I saw the SSI, I'd been in contact with the family of Arlene Fraser. Now, Arlene Fraser was murdered in 1998. Her killer is in custody. Her remains have never been found, and her family understandably support Suzanne's law. And when I pointed out to them that the headlines of December weren't indeed the reality of the SSI, I received response back from Arlene's sister, who said, to be honest, I was quite disappointed. And that was a direct quote, and a rather understated quote. But I think what's worth pointing out is when headlines like these are generated, perhaps through Scottish Government PR, it can actually give false hope to families and further re-traumatise them. It might give an impression that Suzanne's law is indeed coming into being when, in fact, it's not. And I thank Jamie Green for lodging the amendment, because in so doing, John Watt has provided the committee with a very detailed and honest take on what this means. And what he says essentially is that for this to be a, quote, determinative factor in consideration of release, it would require a change to the 1993 legislation. And I'm disappointed to hear the Cabinet Secretary say that he's going to intend to pass an actual Suzanne's Law by revisiting that 1993 legislation. But I do look forward to working with Jamie Green to see if there's a way to find something that's ECHR compliant that can be brought forward, because we've seen this in the other jurisdictions in the United Kingdom. There's Suzanne's Law in Scotland, and there's various other laws elsewhere, all of which have taken the name of female victims, because in almost all of these cases it is female victims. And on that basis, Jamie Green's motion has been absolutely fantastic in flushing out the truth of the matter. I'm perhaps not minded to vote for it, because it's been a useful exercise in gathering it. I'm not sure if he's intending to push it, but that's obviously up to him, because we're not wanting to throw the baby out with the bathwater. It's been a useful exercise in finding out the truth of the matter, so thank you.
OK, thanks very much, Russell. I'll shortly just invite the Cabinet Secretary just to make any further comment that you wish, but can I just stay with the issue of revealing the whereabouts of a victim's body? And I think Cabinet Secretary, you referred specifically to some of the circumstances where there is a consideration around ECHR factors. Would it be the case that might include a situation, for example, where an individual who has been convicted of a murder is actually unable to disclose where the whereabouts of a body? Now, whether that might be through a health condition that they have, or, as I think you mentioned, they can't remember. It might be broadly in an area, but they cannot be specific because of the passage of time. So, essentially, including revealing the whereabouts of a body as part of the parole hearing process is almost sort of two bites of the cherry, given that refusal to reveal the whereabouts prior to sentencing would have already been taken into account in terms of the sentence imposed.
Yeah, I think you raised two very important points, Convener. One is, and I think I mentioned that in the opening statement, if somebody, or how can we be sure that somebody genuinely cannot pass on that information? Mm-hmm. I think that's one of the reasons why it butts up against ECHR law. But I think more profoundly for me, and I think we're all as well to explain our rationale for these things, I think that the court is the right place to do that. When they're handing down a sentence, if they think it's a willful refusal to reveal, which I agree is a for the victim's family, a vitally important piece of information for all the reasons that we're familiar with. I think it's a reprehensible thing to do. But the court can take that into account. What we're asking to do really is for the parole board to be take on the functions almost of sentencing, because you could continually to put the sentence beyond that which the court had handed down, and not least the punishment part of it. So that's my view. I'm happy, as I've said, to listen to other points of view. If people are unhappy, then of course they can annul this measure, or they can bring forward legislation which would change the 1993 Act. I've given the reasons why I think that would be... I don't be too definitive on it, but to me it seems to butt right up against those provisions of the ECHR. So that's my position, that's the government's position. As ever, try to be open-minded if others have got a point of view. Just to make a couple of clarifications, though, they don't have Suzanne's Law or its counterpart in England and Wales, as has been suggested. There is no provision to do that. They have to take, the Pro Board have to take it into account, but they don't have it in the way that's been suggested by those that would propose Suzanne's Law. And also, I can't really be held responsible for BBC stories. Generally in the media, there was a story that I had misled Parliament last year, which was completely fallacious. It was reported in all the media, virtually no corrections to that. I can't really, and quite rightly, govern the media in relation to that. I do, though, think that the review of, and some of the points that have been made, I accept in relation to improvements to the victim notification scheme. That's why we're having the review, and it is an independent review, but of course it can receive representations, and I would encourage those, and I know that Jamie Green in particular has that interest with this bill, to make those representations, and those will be taken into account subsequently. I generally think we can do more to improve that scheme, although we do have to be mindful, as these proposed rules are, not to overstep the mark, such as we re-traumatise people who do not want to have that for their information for perfectly understandable reasons. And I'll leave it there, Convener.
Okay. Thank you very much indeed, Cabinet Secretary. And if I can just also express my thanks to John Watt of the Parole Board for the briefing that he provided committee members with. I think it was very helpful in informing today's debate. So we'll now move to the formal consideration. Oh, I beg your pardon.
Yeah, no, just a small point of worth putting on the record. I think that in relation to similar legislation elsewhere in the UK, the Prisoners Disclosure of Information about Victims Act 2022 was enacted in England and Wales, and indeed has been put into use in specific cases. So just putting that on the record. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, thank you very much. So our next agenda item is formal consideration of a motion to annul the following negative interest instrument, which is the Parole Board Scotland Rules of 2022, and that's SSI number 385 of 2022. And I refer members to paper 2, and I invite Jamie Green to comment on whether he wishes to press his motion or withdraw.
Thank you, Convener. Would I be able to just briefly thank members for their contribution?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. And thank you. I don't want to stretch this out too long, but can I thank those who have contributed and for the Cabinet Secretary's officials for attending today and offering their point of view. I did want to just comment on two brief things, and that's that one is this issue that this change to Rule 11 on matters that the Board may consider, where on the face of the on the face of it says that the Board may take into account, amongst other matters, any failure to reveal the location of a victim's body. This matter may be considered where relevant, but does not change the underlying test for release applied by the Board. To me, it still doesn't make sense, and I wondered if somebody may provide some further, and it could be in writing after today's event, but I still can't see how it can meaningfully be taken into account or be a consideration factor if the overall test is not changing. So essentially, even if somebody refuses to reveal the location of a victim's body, and it is evident that they are doing so willingly as opposed to through inability, will that make any material difference in the decision making around whether parole is granted or not? Because it seems to me the answer to that is no. So I do question how meaningful this change actually is, which is why I think people are disappointed. So I just want to park that there, because I think it's a false sense of hope that we have given perhaps some of those victims' families through this change. I can't see any meaningful application where it would change the status quo, unfortunately. But my views are on the record. Based on the feedback I've had, including from my colleague, I won't be pushing the matter to a vote, convener.
OK. So can you just confirm you're withdrawing?
Withdrawing, therefore, yes. Thank you
very much. OK, so are members content to agree to the motion to annul this instrument?
No, it's withdrawn.
Nope.
It's withdrawn. So
right. Perfect. OK, thank you very much. OK, thank you. In that case, then, we thank you to the witnesses for attending this morning, and we'll pause momentarily just to allow the Cabinet Secretary to leave. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. So our next item of business is to consider the committee's action plan, and I refer members to paper 3. So I intend going through the paper section by section just to confirm if members have any comments or wish to make any amendments or, in fact, disagree with the assessments of progress to date. So if I can start at the first section, which is the impact of COVID and recovery. if any members have got anything that they wish to flag. So we're just at the first section, just on the impact of COVID and recovery. Nothing. Okay. The prisons and prison reform section is next. I wondered if it might just be worth mentioning or including reference to the promise, and particularly in the section on women and children. I think in March 2022, there was an update on that, and given that it refers to it's supporting young people who are care experienced, and ultimately it's seeking to reduce the number of young people in care, maybe just worth including that as for reference. Jamie?
Yep, don't disagree with any of that. There was a further point on the it's an update on the issue of young people being held in adult institutions. Mm-hmm. Not sure what the current numbers are. I know they're always quite low, but it'd be helpful to maybe get an up-to-date number on that. But I also recall that there was a commitment made, which I think I raised in the chamber around some more analysis on the future of the Barnhouse model and the volume or capacity that may be required, which would kick off perhaps some capital investment projects quite early on, given the timescales of them. And my understanding is that there was a piece of work being done that would do some forecasting around that, that would inform the decision-making. So obviously, at the moment, we have one... but I don't know whether that's one of three, five, 12, or that's it. So it's not necessarily relevant to this year's cash flow, but it is quite relevant to future. And also the issue, I think it's quite valid to raise the issue of secure care, secure accommodation. I've had some local casework on that recently, where there still seems to be disparity around... places available, who is fulfilling those places and where the funding for that is coming from. And anecdotally, I know of providers of services like that who claim that there is capacity in the system and they don't understand why there are young people in the adult prison system. And it seems to be a funding issue and follow the money situation, which is causing the issue, so much so that they're actually taking people from south of the border and to keep their head above water financially, and that doesn't seem to make much sense. So maybe that's something we could, when we're doing an overall writing to the government, we could chuck that in. Thank you.
Okay. Yep, that's fine. Thanks, Jamie. We've taken a note of that, so we can follow that up. Katie? Yes.
It's quite clear that there's been considerable investment in the women's estates with the opening of the new two community custody units, but also the new prison at Stirling that we're yet to see. So I just wonder... given what we know about women's offending patterns and the different nature of the women's population compared with the male estate, whether we need to really assess whether these new facilities in reality are providing more appropriate facilities for women given their specific needs, the healthcare issues that we're aware of, their parental responsibilities and medical needs, and whether that's something that we might want to incorporate as, you know, particularly once Stirling is open, to really review whether we feel it delivers in terms of the objectives that have been set over actually many decades.
Thanks, Katie. I think those are all relevant updates. And I think there's support across members in relation to perhaps facilitating a visit to Courton Vale once it's ready to receive visiting groups. So we'll pick that up. I think just that this may be not totally relevant to this section, but I think it is relevant to the action plan. I recently attended the CPG on health inequalities, at which Wendy Gibbon-Sinclair provided an update on prisons and the work around addressing health inequalities in prisons. And one of the points that she made was in relation to the, some of the inspection work that she undertakes. I think her desire that at some point there's an opportunity to undertake a review of the sort of healthcare model within prisons, which I think members would agree is highly relevant to women. So it's maybe just something to note. Okay, thanks very much. Just one point in relation to recovery cafes. There's been quite a bit of work, obviously, courtesy of the National Drugs Death Task Force report and the work coming out of that. But I'm not seeing an awful lot of specific reference to recovery cafes. So I think it's just one for us to monitor in terms of progress on that particular action. Okay, thanks very much. Colette?
Yeah, it was more a comment rather than you know, a request for further information. But just on observing this report, I think it's a good news story about the progress that's been made in terms of in-cell telephony and how that's commenced and taken forward. Obviously, we'll be getting regular updates as to, you know, how that's been rolled out and the benefits and you know, any feedback at all would be very much welcome. But yeah, I think it's a very good thing. I just wanted to sort of congratulate you know, SPS on taking that forward, really.
Okay. Thanks very much. Yeah, well, that's noted. Okay. Okay, so we'll just move through the action plan. I think we're possibly at around page 10.
17 on misuse of drugs. If you've never announced on prisons, it's page 17 on misuse of drugs.
Yeah. Okay, I'll bring in Russell and then I'll come back to Colette.
I suppose this relates to the point that starts on page 7, residential rehabilitation, and ends on page 9.
Mm-hmm.
Let's talk about various funding. The Audit Scotland have talked about this quite recently, essentially saying that there is a lack of clarity around how this money is being spent. And with that lack of clarity, there's a lack of ability to then evaluate its effectiveness.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if that's the place for it or if there's somewhere further on that that would be more relevant, but just thought it would be worth making the point.
Well, we can note that and then we can maybe insert that just at the relevant part of the action plan. I think so. Thanks for that, Russell.
March last year from recollection, and then they did a follow-up one, I think, in October-ish.
Okay. I think just one other final addition, perhaps, is that, again, end of page 7, under residential rehabilitation. It was a recent statement on residential rehab by the Drugs Policy Minister. I think that was back in January this year. That provided an update of an £18 million commitment to develop stabilisation and crisis care services and align them with detox and rehabilitation. But I think we could get more information on that in the official report. Okay, thank you. If we move through, if there's no more specific issues around prisons and prison reform, Jamie?
Did you, when I briefly popped out, did you cover recovery cafes?
Recovery cafes, yeah.
You did cover it?
Yes, as in there wasn't much of an
just
update on that.
And funding and whether they would be a feature of every institution or not. Thank you.
Okay. So if we move on to misuse of drugs and the criminal justice system, which is at page 17.
I thought we were doing it page by page. My mistake. It was just on page 12, the under-18 secure care, just to say that I welcome that the Justice Committee will be looking at that aspect of the bill. I know the rest of the bill will be going probably to the Education Committee, I imagine. But I just wanted to say as well at this stage that I had a meeting, and I think other members may have been contacted by them as well, but I had a meeting with Hope Instead of Handcuffs, a good organisation, and they're doing work around the way that young people are treated on their transport to secure. So it might be worthwhile thinking about them for an evidence session around about the time of that bill. I know we'd talk about that at another stage, but I just wanted to raise that, and I would encourage members to meet with this organisation.
I agree. I think that's probably a helpful suggestion, Jamie.
I should declare an interest. I also had a meeting with them, and others have as well. So they're very effective lobbying. I do understand that there is a commercial interest behind the campaign, and I think that's entirely appropriate that we note that. But nonetheless, I think, giving them the benefit of the doubt, they have a genuine interest in the issue of transportation. It's certainly not the first time this committee has raised the issue of the contractors involved in that service, and some reservations have been expressed about it. To be fair, I did have some questions to them about the scenarios where it would be entirely appropriate to restrain a young person for their safety or the safety of staff and others around them, and I think that there's an acceptance that should remain the case. But I think we should, it needs to be evidence-based, and I think if there is genuine evidence of, inappropriate behaviour, then that should come to our attention. But it also should be a matter of public record and not just hearsay and gossip. So, if there are genuine examples of where young people have been, misappropriately managed, then I think people should be forthcoming with those, and the government can address those issues directly rather than just it become a hearsay issue, because then it's we've no idea the truth of the matter otherwise. But certainly they made some valid points, and it's important to raise those.
Okay, thanks, Jamie. Happy to look at an opportunity around that. I'll bring in Russell and then Katie.
Just a very small point, page 13, in relation to, it makes reference to the Scottish Sentencing Council's recently published guidelines for sentencing young people. I just think it might benefit from being a bit more specific, so maybe even a link, but certainly the date of when these were published and when they came into effect.
Okay,
I'm not entirely sure when that was. But
Thank you. Katie?
Yes, I mean, just to pick up on the issue that Fulton raised in terms of the use of handcuffs, and I suspect that he knows far more about the issue than myself in relation to the rules and guidelines that exist in terms of residential care, like children's homes, etc. And the issue, as I understood it, was that the regulation that exists in some settings doesn't exist in the transportation setting. So it would be useful if we could get some detail on that before we start looking at it as an issue, if we could actually have a proper briefing before we take any evidence, because I don't have that background, and I think that would be useful for the committee, rather than to take it from witnesses, to actually be given copies of all the regulations that exist in different settings. I was going to raise an issue in relation to page 13, remand. I don't know if that's appropriate, and it relates to some of the evidence that we've seen in relation to the bail bill. I mean, the women's remand rate is even higher than the men's. The men's rate is approaching 30% of the prison population. The women's rate was between 35 to 40% of the population was actually unconvicted prisoners, which I was quite alarmed by. And I know that we've had real difficulty as a committee getting data in terms of offending patterns, and I just think it might be useful to incorporate that as work going forward, that we need to have a better understanding of who's in the prison population, both on remand and indeed in the general population, but in relation to remand and to try and see that the differences that have happened over time and that are happening. My impression is that there's more violent prisoners and more prisoners who have been charged or indeed convicted of very serious sexual offences, including rape and child sexual abuse, including historic cases. But I think we need to have a better understanding of that. And I don't know if that could be incorporated in the work programme, because it has been like pulling teeth trying to get that information as a committee. And I know SPICE have have, you know, endeavoured and have tried to provide what's available, but I do think it's actually, I think it's very difficult for us to scrutinise without that data, so I think it would be helpful, and also to you know, highlight the differences between the male estate and the female estate. I think we need to have an understanding of both.
OK, thanks very much. I think probably in relation to the second point about just monitoring the remand population, I think your impression is probably correct. I'm certainly happy to consider some work around monitoring remand populations out with the scope of bail and release, which obviously will conclude shortly. So, happy to look at that as, because I mean, it's clearly a pressing issue that we've been grappling with. Russell.
Sorry, it's the same box that Katie refers to, but slightly mm-hmm. different point. So page 13 in relation to remand, it begins by saying remand numbers are not falling significantly and ends by saying that remand has dropped by 9% within 12 months. So that, I mean, arguably is significant. I just wonder if there's a way of rewording the opening thing to be a bit less subjective.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a fair point to raise. I think really...
remains steady or something.
Yeah, and I think really this... The action plan is almost a chronology of development, so okay. I'm not overly worried about the fact that that doesn't seem to fit. Things fluctuate and change as time goes on. But happy if you would prefer an update, that's absolutely fine. Okay, Jamie.
That point, yes, there is a contradiction reading this by saying remand numbers are not yet falling, but then saying they've reduced 10%. I appreciate their fluctuations. 10% is quite meaty, and I don't know if the government were using that statistic, they would hail it as a success, so they wouldn't say it was a constant. So, but the wider point that Katie Clark I think is making is that this needs to be contextual, and that's around the issue of not just the numbers falling, but the perceived percentage of the overall population, and monitoring that as a measurement rather than just the number itself. But it doesn't really take into account two factors, and that's the crime profile, or the profile of those being held on remand, given that the lion's share of them are being remanded from charges which would follow solemn proceedings, therefore, by default, more serious. But also it doesn't take into account, and this goes back to the how many of those people out of that 25 to 29%, as the numbers fluctuate, are there because of delays to trials, because that, I don't know if that's 10% or all of them or some of them or half of them. So there may be a cohort of people who are held on remand who otherwise would not be had their trial come to pass. And I think that's something that we need to be cognizant about in this as well.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm just conscious of the time. We've still got a number of agenda items to work through. So if I can just circle back to the section on misuse of drugs, which starts at 17. Page 17. If there are no particular updates or additions to that, can I move us swiftly on to the next section, which is on violence against women and girls? So, page 23 is the section relating to violence against women and girls. And then, if there's nothing that members wish to highlight, the next section is on victims' rights and victim support, which is at page 28. Happy with that.
Mm-hmm. So it's in the last column, the points where the committee could ask the Scottish Government to, or the Scottish Government could be asked to, or the committee could ask COSLA to, or third sector to. Mm-hmm. I just, for the record, I agree with all of those suggestions, and because we're skipping past pages, I think it's important that we give consent to the clerks to carry on with that work.
I totally agree with that. I think that there's quite a lot coming out of our discussion today, so certainly the clerks will, on our behalf, update the action plan accordingly. And if members do feel that there are maybe technical additions that they want to add to the action plan, very happy for members to contact the clerks direct with those updates. Okay, so victims' rights and victim support starts at page 28. I don't have anything for that. And then the next section is reducing youth offending, and that is at page 32. Yep. So, Jamie and Katie.
Thank you. I know we are heavily skipping pages here now, but I wanted to raise the issue of access to court transcripts. I don't know where that fits in or which page that fits in.
I think one of our forthcoming agenda items.
Yep. I'll shut up then.
Mm-hmm. Katie?
Yes, it was on the youth offending and community justice solutions. And when we were looking at the budgets, there seemed to be, and it's the point that I think we'll probably be discussing in more detail when we talk about the bail bill. It's quite clear what the intention is in terms of the bail bill legislation, in terms of a shift towards community justice, but definitely in terms of the budgets for the coming year, starting in April, it's actually those budgets are getting cut. And I just think as a committee, that's something that we maybe need to look at in terms of how that money's spent, but how maybe even a relatively modest increase might actually reap rewards. So I just wonder if that's something the committee would want to consider incorporating, because, you know, if that legislation goes through, which it's likely to do, then, you know, there's a risk and there's actually nothing's going to change. Mm-hmm. Unless there's a structural shift in terms of where the money goes. And so I just wonder if that's something we want to incorporate and to monitor that maybe more heavily than other areas that we're looking at, particularly given we spent so much time scrutinising the legislation.
Mm-hmm. OK, thanks, Katie. Yeah, I'm happy with that. We've taken a note of that suggestion. OK, where did we get to? Page 32. And then that is, and then the final section, I've skipped over, is legal aid on page 36.
We're skipping. Page 34, deaths in custody. Are we content as a committee that that's an issue that's been followed up by a note from the analysis of whether the Scottish Government agreed with our recommendation? The Government pushed back and said it had no intention to create an online centralised system where delivery of recommendations can be tracked. If we were content with that response, or we wanted to push the Government further on it? Because it's still a very live issue, unfortunately, and tragically.
Okay. That's noted, and we can follow that up just to get an up-to-date position on that. Okay. And if there's nothing else, we'll bring this to a close. Obviously, members are very welcome if there are additional comments that you want to make on the action plan. I'm happy for you to link directly with the clerks if it's a more of a technical update. So thank you for that. And I do appreciate that we've worked through that quite quickly. We'll return to our action plan later in the year just to see what further progress is being made to deliver on the recommendations and actions that we've set out. So thank you very much. Okay, so our next agenda item
is consideration of the correspondence from Police Scotland, the SPA, the Scottish Police Federation and the Association of Scottish Police Superintendents on policing and mental health. And I refer members to paper 4. And I invite members to comment on the correspondence and any suggested follow-up that you wish to see, and also the proposed actions at paragraphs 24 and 25. If I can maybe just before members come in, I think for the record, I'm very pleased that we've had the opportunity to consider this issue. It is an important issue, and that there is support for this work around policing and mental health, and support for that to continue and develop. So as such, I think the proposed actions in the paper, I feel are a way of ensuring that the work continues. And indeed, I know that the SPA are keen to have a role in that. So with that, I'm happy to open it up to members for your comments and thoughts. So.
Yeah, I absolutely welcome the fact this is being talked about. However, I think the Federation, Scottish Police Federation, makes some quite worrying points about the position of Police Scotland being what they describe as defensive, in denial, and suggests nothing to see here, which I think chimes with my experience of having tried to raise a number of suicide cases of police officers where we've established none were subject of fatal accident inquiries. Police Scotland do not record the numbers of deaths, let alone is there any form of inquiry into them. And still, Police Scotland and the SPA in their responses don't seem to be addressing this. I know it's uncomfortable, but the amount of officers and former officers who've come forward to me who have either considered to take their own lives, attempted to take their own lives, or the families of those who indeed have taken their own lives, all drawing direct links to the officers' experience of either the lack of support from the police due to their what they've experienced as police officers, or even worse, due to protracted regulatory disciplinary processes which they feel were unfair and unjust, to the point where they were in such dire straits and such desperate mental state that they believed suicide was the only option. And as bad and as shocking as that is, in many of these cases, these individuals made these feelings known to Police Scotland. And you know, if you think back to when this first arose in the committee, it was actually, I think it was a year or two ago, and the responses from Police Scotland, the SPA, set alarm bells ringing. And for all that they're, you know, appearing to say all the right things about consideration of officers' well-being, which is great, I think they're falling well short of acknowledging the scale of the damage that has been done and could yet cause serious problems. So in terms of action plans, we've got a response from the Crown Office explaining that none of these cases have been subject to a fatal accident inquiry. Is there any mechanism that we can explore as to give an officer who's died from suicide the same rights as someone who's died in custody who automatically is subject to a fatal accident inquiry? Because in the cases I'm aware of, it would absolutely highlight serious issues about these officers, the pressure they were under. And not to point fingers, not to lay blame, but to realise how serious the situation is and learn from it. I think if it's a superficial exercise, nothing will change. So thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. I've taken some notes on that, so we'll come back to that. Jamie.
Thank you. I want to start with the section on Police Scotland, and I think this is a great summary. Can I thank the clerks for it? But I then kind of jump to page four, which is the actions. And the actions seem to be that we ask the SPA to do some work. I think we need to take a step back first and go straight to back to Police Scotland, because our... is this? I presume this is a matter of public record. Okay, thank you. If you look at points 5, 6, 7, and 8 of the papers, mm-hmm. we as a committee, and have now put it on record, are clearly unhappy with the response from Police Scotland, and I think we have more than enough opportunity to go back to them. So we state in point 5 that the response does not include an explanation as to why officers that we spoke to did not receive the standard of advice and support required. In point 6, we complain that the response from the Police Scotland does not address key issues raised by the committee. In point 7, we also say that the issue is not addressed in the response, that being the inadequacy of the employee assistance line. And in point 8, the committee requests details of when the court scheduling system redesign will be in place. That information has also not been provided. So there are very specific things that we think they have not responded to, and I would invite them to respond to. Let's give them a second chance to respond to that before we escalate it. We're very happy to include the SPA in our correspondence, of course, but let's go straight to Police Scotland with that information, explaining that we're unhappy with their response. Let's be upfront about it. As uncomfortable as that may be. Going on to the SPF, we could include in that, of course, the challenges made by the SPF. I know Police Scotland will read this themselves, but if they're not asked to answer to it, then they don't have to and probably won't. I would like them to directly respond to the concerns raised by the SPF. The concerns raised, is, for example, in point 16, that the SPA bases its oversight on evidence provided by Police Scotland, but not necessarily by officers directly. That's a really key point, actually. In other words, you know, the SPA seems to be marking its own homework by only responding to evidence given to it by Police Scotland, which, of course, is accountable to it, but not necessarily by going directly to staff associations or organisations to get feedback and to really just sanity check whether what it's hearing from Police Scotland marries up with the truth on the ground. And that's maybe a criticism of the SPA. And again, equally in point 17, there is specific complaints made about the strategic commitment to wellbeing from Police Scotland and the mainstreaming of that policy. The SPF believe that this is a failure to operate, either a failure to operationalise the programme or a failure to operationalise the right programme. Again, we could invite Police Scotland or indeed the SPA to respond to that. I don't disagree with what we are asking the SPA to do around data collection and how they could better engage with officers and their representatives from the union or otherwise, and whether that sort of data collection could be beefed up. I think that those are valid things, but I think they're not necessarily the main criticisms that we want to pose to them. So I feel like this is actually what was quite a short paper is clearly quite... is one where we express an unhappiness of what we've heard in response from Police Scotland, and I think we need to challenge that, which would be my only plea.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you very much. Rona?
Thank you. I agree with Jamie, particularly on point 16 about the SPF raising the concern that the SPA bases oversight on evidence provided by Police Scotland and they don't have much input. So I agree that we should take that point up. I'm not really in agreement so much with Jamie on his first point, which is to go back to Police Scotland. I think we've been there. They know we're not happy with the response. The SPA know we're not happy with the response. They are the authority that governs Police Scotland, so I think the onus is on them to get this right mm-hmm. for the police and for us and to give us the information. And paragraph 11 says, in response to the committee's request, the SPA undertook an urgent review of the number of cases where officers and staff retired due to mental health, etc., etc. The SPA confirms that in the response, additional resources have been assigned and are having a positive impact in reducing the number of officers awaiting approval. But we don't know, we have no update on that. So, you know, urgent review, what was the outcome of all that? And it says the committee is going to consider the outcomes of the review at its meeting on the 28th of February. So that might be timely for us to contact them and say, OK, what was the outcome of that? So I'm not sure of the value of going back to Police Scotland, because I think we'll just get the same response.
OK, thank you very much. Anybody else want to come in very quickly?
Just very quickly on point 16, which Jamie and Rona have both referred to. I think this perhaps is a more fundamental issue about the creation of Police Scotland, which is coming up for its 10th birthday, and the fact SPAs, that the short history of both the SPA and Police Scotland has been tumultuous, to say the least. And at the very beginning, there were serious questions about both the ability or willing of SPA to hold Police Scotland sufficiently to account, and indeed in the early days political meddling, which has now been pretty much acknowledged. And I think going back to the specific issue, in May 2021 we raised the issue of officer suicides in the committee. Then we got a letter in September 2021, and in that letter the SPA wrote to us to say that based on the information available at the time, there was nothing to suggest that any of the recent cases were caused directly by the pressure of work. Mm-hmm. They took that information from Police Scotland. They took Police Scotland at their word. And I think it's disingenuous to say the least, because in some of these cases, these officers had made known their difficulties with the ongoing processes they were being put through. And that, I think, in one brief letter highlights the problem of the SPA showing perhaps a lack of curiosity or robustness in respect of holding Police Scotland to account and asking difficult questions about difficult subjects.
OK, thanks very much. Anybody else want to come in? No? OK, just to try and summarise, thanks very much for your comments. I think they're all perfectly valid. So I think the key issues that have been raised from Russell are around the commentary on police suicides and some of the previous responses that we've had, including the correspondence from the Crown Office on police suicides. We've got Jamie's comments and proposal around going back to Police Scotland and asking further questions, including on the comments made by the Scottish Police Federation. And correct me if I'm picking this up wrongly, because I've been trying to scribble some notes. And there are some other issues that have also been raised. I think part of the reason for the actions that we set out was to try and, what I don't want is to sort of get into a kind of just a sort of correspondence, chain of correspondence. However, I think in view of the comments that have been raised and the points made, I would open it up to members to indicate if they're happy for us to go back to Police Scotland on the specific issues that have been highlighted. So our members happy for that to be an action for us to take away?
Russell.
Yep, Russell.
Yeah, could the letter perhaps ask for some more data around, I mean, when we had a police witness in here and we asked about the number of officer suicides, he said he'd come back to us and he hasn't done so. Mm-hmm. We've corresponded with him since, they've shown no sign of providing this information. So we asked specifically for that, and also for how many of these officers were subject to ongoing processes, internal processes. Mm-hmm. And in light of the fact we have raised this now publicly and in writing with both the SPA and Police Scotland, whether they've revisited this acceptance by the SPA that there's nothing to see here, when in fact there clearly is.
Mm-hmm. So. Okay, thanks. And very quickly, Jamie.
Thank you for your proposal, and I think that's a good move. I agree, I don't think there's any merit in getting into letter tennis with them.
Mm-hmm.
But if it gets to the point where we're expressing unhappiness about the response we're getting, then we can't just park it there. I think that's the point I'm probably making. I also think that there is maybe one other thing we could ask for a more regular update on, and that's something I've struggled to get information on, is officer retirement and churn. And I appreciate they do their own analysis on those who are exiting, and there'll be exit interviews and so on. I've tried to chuck some questions into the system on that, and it's been very difficult to get data. And I think that data is quite important, so that we get below the skin of why people are retiring. Is it just simply early retirement? Is it changes to rules around that? Is it, or is it genuine mental health or other health, physical health? Being, you know, what are the reasons that are being given? And are we keeping a watching track on the churn rates relative to the number of officers in the system and the age, you know, the average ages and so on? So I think there needs to be a proactive effort, either by the police themselves or from the government, to keep the committee informed of that data. Doesn't matter what it's telling us, but we need to know what picture it's painting, because that will have a massive effect on the number of officers available. So.
And I think, just, Rowan, I'll bring you in. I agree. I think alongside this, whatever we're doing, I think it is really important that we support clear arrangements, if you like, around data collection, because that's absolutely fundamental to tracking progress on these, the range of issues that we've highlighted.
Mm. Yeah, just briefly. I mean, I agree with you about data collection. That's crucial. I mean, I've no objection to going back to Police Scotland. I just question the worth of that. I definitely think we should go back to the SPA about the their review that they're doing, etc. Just for an update on that, more than anything else, but also to ask them about this point 16 and why the SPF doesn't really have a voice at their meetings, and why they just take. They take the evidence from Police Scotland as read. In other words, ask them how robust they've been with their governance. Mm-hmm. You know, that's what I would like to do, just to see if we get anywhere.
Yep. Okay. Yep. No, I'm happy with that suggestion. So, can I just ask members, if I can just move this on, Russell, can I just ask members for an indication of their view on going back to Police Scotland to ask some further questions. I know, Rona, you're...
No, I think I have to go with it.
Okay. Yep. Are members agreed on that?
Yeah.
Yep. Okay, that's fine. Are members agreed to also to the actions that are in the paper in relation to the SPA? Because I think those are... They have an important role, whether, you know, despite the comments that we... are, and some of our views on the SPA and scrutiny, are we nonetheless happy to accept the actions proposed?
Yep.
Okay, thanks very much. Can I just bring in Stephen, just in case there's anything else that I've missed? I don't think there is.
No, I think we're fairly clear in terms of a letter to Police Scotland on the various issues that have been raised, plus taking forward the paragraph, the actions in paragraphs 24 and 25.
Mm-hmm. Okay, finally.
Just worth, I think, putting on the record that the His Majesty's Inspectorate of Constabulary Scotland has just issued its terms of reference for a thematic review into policing mental health in Scotland, and they're due to publish according to their initial report in July. Mm-hmm. So presumably they are asking the very same questions we are asking, and perhaps have greater access to a lot of this stuff than we do. Mm-hmm. So just to put that in the context of all this, it's...
it's a helpful update.
Yeah,
thanks for that. Okay, thank you, members. And I think just before we conclude this item, I'd like to place on record the committee's thanks to David Hamilton, Chair of the Scottish Police Federation, for bringing this issue to our attention. As we know, David is moving on from his role as Chair of the Scottish Police Federation. And so on behalf of the committee, I'd like to wish him well in his future endeavours and whatever challenges he's going to move on to next. OK, thank you very much. OK, thank you very much. So our next item is consideration
of correspondence from the Lord Justice General, the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service and the Scottish Government on virtual trials. And I refer members to paper 5 and I'll open it up to members for comments. Katie?
Yes, I think this is really interesting. I think the with the exception of the issue of juries and cinemas, which has been pointed out by Lady Dorian, which I hadn't always really thought of as virtual trials, but it obviously is. I think that the main thing that comes through to me is actually how few mm-hmm. virtual trials are taking place. I thought Lady Dorian's comment that there'd been no appreciable difference in the figures for conviction, acquittal or plea rates in relation to the cases where there were juries and cinemas was really interesting. I suspect we've probably seen that data in a different way in a different place, but we hadn't necessarily thought about where the juries were. But in terms of the mainly summary issues, I think it just is striking how few trials have taken place. And I just think that the point really I'd want to make is that if there was any more long-term proposals being made, I think we need a far more substantial evidence base. And just as a committee, I think that's really, the position we should take. If there are any proposals to come forward with something more substantial in legislation, which may happen, I think, it's quite important to put down the marker that it should be evidence-led. And at the moment, the sample's just too small.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you. Anybody else want to come in? Jamie?
Thank you, just give me a sec. So I noted some of the comments in the letter from the SCTS to us, which I just wanted to flag. On the first page, it's page 3, third paragraph down. Despite the increasing numbers of domestic abuse cases across our courts, they're currently making up 23% of all summary complaints at Aberdeen, for example, there are currently no further virtual summary trials scheduled at this point. It then sort of explains the reason why, and that's there seems to be a problem with solicitor participation, but doesn't really explain what that challenge is. Is it that solicitors aren't available or aren't willing to participate or are expressing opposition to it, or just simply there aren't any available? It's really unclear, actually. I appreciate that it also then does talk about the sort of generality. I'm about halfway down the page. That we are moving to a more face-to-face world again from doing things virtually. It actually says as people return to more day-to-day physical interaction, as we recover from the pandemic, momentum is waning. So that kind of says to me that we gave it a try, it was okay, but the world's sort of back to normal. No one really wants to continue with this. So that kind of flags that, whatever your view on virtual trials, and I segregate that from virtual evidence giving or virtual juries, for example, which is a different application of technology. But it seems like SCTS aren't really 100% behind doing much more of this, and there seems to be an unwillingness in the sector to see benefits to it. I think they quoted the number 58 as being the total number of motions for a fully virtual trial, but of which actually, not very many actually went through to be a virtual trial. In fact, about half of them were converted to an in-person trial. So the request wasn't granted, or indeed the decision was made not to. So I just really want to question, as Katie Clark says, it's quite limited information, but it was only a limited trial anyway. But it certainly, this doesn't reek to me of a very positive outcome or very positive feedback about it.
Okay, thank you very much. Anybody else want to come in? Colette?
Yeah, it's just, it is quite interesting. It's almost like we've tried it out let's move on. And the thing is, when we're looking at budget cuts and all the rest of it, there's huge efficiencies to be made here, particularly when you look at prisoners attending court. They could be doing it virtually rather than having to use the likes of GeoAmy to attend court. Mm-hmm. And I mean, there seemed to be pushback as well. That was an observation I made at Glasgow Sheriff Court, that there seemed to be some pushback for having virtual trials as well. And again, for a variety of reasons, even for the police as well, and, you know, having to use up their rest days, they could be attending virtually. You know, and that way they're not having to get replaced or, you know, depending on obviously how long the trial lasts and whatnot as well. But, you know, they could be attending virtually. So there's a huge amount of efficiencies to be made here for carrying on with virtual trials, mm-hmm. notwithstanding the issue over, you know, the actual complainers and the impact it has on them as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thanks very much. Pauline?
Yeah, I mean, it's probably quite important to get to the bottom of that, but I mean, just kind of my observations around the points that Colette has made is that, so not all in custody cases, not everybody's held in the same place, so that's one of the practical things for lawyers. So you have the right to see your lawyer, but if they're not in the same court as maybe they used to be, so there are practical issues. Mm-hmm. Also, there's a quality of the... I'm not in favour of proceeding to virtual arrangements unless I'd be satisfied that the quality of the connection is good enough. So I think we'd need to see, well, what investment are the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service prepared to make? I mentioned this previously, one of the custody hearings that I sat in, I found the quality really poor. And also, I guess you'd need to run some pilots, even in a high quality arrangement, just to see, well, what is, if you're running a full trial like that, what does that feel like for a jury if they're not in the room? So it's interesting to note that there's not been a change, apparently, in the overall conviction rates, which, so it's a good premise to work on. Lastly, in relation to the appearance of police officers, I take Colette's point, could that be an area? It got to be an area, whether we use virtual trials or other ways to reduce police time in court. But I would like to put on record, and one of the reasons that we introduced preliminary trials was for that reason. The purpose of preliminary proceedings was that the witnesses were not required, so police prior to that would be sitting in court. So all the disruption and delays in the court system right now are impacting on police officers using their rest days and so on. So I think that's an important point maybe to return to about police time being really important, given the other budget discussions that we would be having around the importance of maintaining police numbers. Mm-hmm. So I just thought I'd kind of add that in for the record. I'm not against using more virtual to where that's... I mean, the commissioning of evidence, I'm quite impressed with that because I've seen the facilities that... mentioned this in the debate yesterday that Victim Support Scotland have. It looks high quality arrangement. It looks quite satisfactory. There's other requirements to check. There's no one else in the room. It looks pretty solid. But I think in moving forward to a different, well, not physical arrangement, I think we need to be satisfied that all these things are present. Thank you.
Thank you, Pauline. And I'll just... mention, I think the issue that you raise about police officer abstractions for courts is a really important one, albeit I know that, for example, in North East Division recently, I think on a Monday morning, there were 150 officers cited for court. Now, I know, obviously, that will reduce with trials going off, but that's got huge implications for operational policing. Russell.
Yeah, thank you. I don't want to sound negative for us, like I'm always complaining, but we've had witnesses in here who we've asked these basic questions of, as in how many of these trials have taken place, what was the nature of the crimes, what was the disposal rate, how did that compare to disposal rates in a non-virtual courts and so on, and it's taken now to finally get something like what we're looking for and some data. And it's slightly underwhelming and perhaps reveals what we suspected, which is that there's a kind of half-hearted attempt here. And I think what's worth bearing in mind is that SCTS could spend millions of pounds creating all the bespoke centres and all the best technology available, but if the judiciary and the defence lawyers don't like it, it's not going to happen. And I think that is the very point being made in the paragraph Jamie Green identified at the outset. It may be that I'm wrong, maybe that they are all for it and there's just been technical difficulties, but I think it's been a reluctance, probably, judicial and defence lawyer. And that, frankly, is where the power lies. I don't really think the SCTS can force anyone to embrace this.
I would agree 100% with those comments. I think it is the reasons that you've just set out, and I think you're right. This cannot be mandated practice. Obviously, we referred earlier to the practice note that informs the practice that is expected, but it doesn't have a role of mandating practice. So that makes it more difficult. Sorry, Jamie, I think you were wanting
simply asking if I know you always get to that, what you plan to do next at the end of the discussion. Yeah. So I may be preempting that, but I do feel, given what we've heard, it's entirely appropriate to go back to the SCTS. I don't see the point in writing to the Cabinet Secretary, because his very short response says it's an operational matter. Mm-hmm. It's not for me to comment on. So let's talk to, straight to the heart of the matter here, hear from the horse's mouth. What are the difficulties? What is their general feeling? I'd like to hear more of their opinion rather than just the facts as well. But equally, I'm not convinced we got the outcomes of these trials. I know they were limited in numbers, but if you were a data analyst trying to work out whether virtual trials produce different outcomes, pretty sure you wouldn't be able to come to a conclusion off of what we've received. Mm-hmm. So from an academic point of view, it's impossible to say whether they've been successful or not.
Okay, I'm going to just pull things together, hopefully. I think there's been some really relevant points raised. There's been very few trials undertaken, I think, despite the support for the notion of virtual trials, and members have highlighted some very relevant points. We do need a much more substantial evidence base. It is concerning that the momentum is waning, if that is the case, but the fact is the reality seems to be at odds with what is happening in our court system. I think good points to raise about budget implications for virtual trials, quality of connections, things like that are all practical, but they're nonetheless important. And it is good to see better use of a virtual option for taking evidence on commission. I think that was highlighted in some of the correspondence that we received. My proposal is, not sure members will all agree, but for next steps, I would propose that we note the discussion that we've had today and that this matter will be the subject of further consideration in the forthcoming Criminal Justice Reform Bill. However, Jamie, your last comments there suggest that you would prefer to go back to SCTS with some further questions.
Only if members are minded to. Again, we go back to the ping-pong scenario, but mm-hmm. I think they've tried to respond to us with a lot of information, but I don't think they've fully answered mm-hmm. maybe more of the question of perception of whether the trials have been successful or not, and the sorts of challenges that they think they faced in trying to implement them. And I think, again, as others have mentioned, we don't really know what other parts of the judiciary, mm-hmm. Their experiences of it were, and whether they were positive or otherwise. So that's what I want to unearth.
Yeah, okay. Thanks for that, Jamie. My proposal would still be that we note the discussion today and that we await the next bill coming forward. I've noted your comments and your preference, but if committee members are in agreement, my proposal would be that we note the discussion this morning. Okay?
We don't need to write to them.
Thank you very much for that permission. Okay, moving swiftly on to our next agenda item, which is access to court transcripts and consideration of the Scottish Government response to court, the issue of court transcripts that we have raised recently. And I refer members to paper 6. So once again, I'd like to invite members for any views on the correspondence. Russell, and then Jamie.
Sure, thank you. So, Ellie Wilson is a rape victim who has been very vocal on this and has been campaigning on this and to declare an interest. She used to work for me, and she just in the past couple of days made it be known that she had now acquired some of the transcripts that she'd been seeking, but had to resort to a crowdfunding to make that affordable. Mm-hmm. I don't know the costs, but I think from what we learned before, they were quite significant. Mm-hmm. It looks like in the response from Keith Brown that there's at least some acknowledgement of this being an important and serious issue. I mean, you could be cynical and say that putting a web page and explaining that there is a process is not great progress, but it's progress. It's showing that indeed that people have somewhere to begin. He also talks, I think, about the potential route of subject access review as opposed to seeking a full transcript. I don't know how that would work in practice. And he also talks about exploring new technology. I'm assuming what he perhaps means is software that transcribes mm-hmm. automatically, mm-hmm. which I've used and perhaps isn't as good as it will ultimately be. So it's being talked about, it's being mm-hmm. considered, but where we go next, I'm not entirely sure.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you for that. Jamie?
Thank you. Yeah, I did want to raise this, and thanks for allowing me the chance to again do so. And I put on record my thanks to Ellie, who contacted me also on the matter, and for the very public work that she's doing. It can't be easy as a survivor of the nature of the crime that she is to talk about this in the public domain, in the media. But it's really important, because when people do that, people listen. And I think the issue I have with this letter is, well, jumping to the end, is it says, in a proactive effort to improve transparency, we will publish information including the costs on what type of transcript is required and so on. The only thing that's becoming more transparent is how clearly onerous and expensive the process is. If nothing else, they've fulfilled that ambition. I have a question, though, that I don't think this letter answers, and that's around the contract and the tender. I take real issue, actually, with the second paragraph of this letter. So we've been raising this since this committee started. After it was set up after the last election. And this was one of those issues that came on the agenda quite early, and we've raised it numerous times. How on earth we could get to a situation now where the current contract is, I quote, due for renewal imminently, and whilst procurement timescales do not allow for adjustments to be made to the tender on this occasion, blah, blah, blah. How did we get in that scenario? We've been flagging this with the Cabinet Secretary for over a year. So we've now discovered that the contract actually is being renewed, presumably on the same terms, at the same costs. Nobody knows what these costs are. We don't know what the tender is valued at. We don't know who operates the tender. We don't know what procurement process went through. But had that been identified to us a year ago, perhaps we could have asked the government to change the criteria of the tender or to be a little bit more transparent about that process. All this says to me is that either the contract's been extended or renewed without any due tender process, or if there has been a tender process, it's been on the same terms as the last one, which is completely unacceptable. This product of work will be reflected when the contract is next due out for tender. Well, when is that? How long is the contract? Is that a 1-year contract, a 2, a 3, a 5? Are we now looking at the next session of Parliament? to revisit this issue that we've been banging on about simply because the government has shooed through another contract with no questions answered. I find this really unacceptable, a scenario. And this raises more questions than answers, I'm afraid. So we have to... It's a shame the Cabinet Secretary isn't here, like he was earlier, to answer these questions. I would like some answers about how on earth we're in a situation where this contract's been renewed exactly the same, onerous costs, so we're back into square one, and we've kicked this back into the long grass. That's all we're going to get any time we raise this issue again. It's unacceptable.
Okay, thanks very much. Anybody else want to come in very quickly?
I will be brief. I actually find this quite bizarre that we have discussed this so many times, and I feel like we are none the wiser in terms of what the issues are. I suspect, as I've said before, is that the issues are of substantial cost. And I say that as someone that used to work in the courts, and I know that getting transcripts was really, really expensive, and that was a long time ago. So I suspect there's very substantial costs involved in this issue, and that's why it's been difficult to get progress. I just don't understand why the Cabinet Secretary and the Scottish Government aren't just sharing that information with us so that we could have an informed discussion and debate about the issue. So I just don't really understand why there isn't a bit more straight talking and transparency on the issue, because I'm guessing what the issues are. It's not being provided to us, and we're getting meaningless correspondence from the Scottish Government.
OK, thank you. Russell, final point.
I was come back to the point Jamie made. I wonder if we're unpicking or asking for details about the tender. My presumption would be that there wouldn't be a huge amount of people probably seeking transcripts. So would it have really made a significant difference to the cost of the contract? Mm-hmm. It's maybe a bit of an academic question, but for our writing to them anyway, it's worth perhaps including questions of that nature.
Yep. Okay. Thank you. And finally, Rona, I think you want to come in.
Disagreeing with what's been said, and we do need to ask questions. If there's any light to shine on it, the second last paragraph, they're going to make the information available on their web pages, and it'll include costs and information and how to get it, etc. I think is a move forward. That doesn't mean to say I don't think there's questions that need to be asked. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thanks for that. And I would concur with the comments that members have made. So I think just to sort of pull things together, can I propose then that we write to the Cabinet Secretary just to ask for more detail on the scope of the contract, the new contract, and why this couldn't have perhaps been provided earlier, as you've pointed out, Jamie. I think there's scope for us to maybe build a bit more of a case around the provision of transcripts for those that are seeking copies. It might also be helpful if we were to ask, for example, Scottish Women's Aid and Rape Crisis Scotland, who will be, will be very interested and will be following this matter, perhaps for an update on how easy or challenging it is currently for individuals to obtain copies of transcripts. Is there still a significant cost? Has anything changed in that regard? And I think it would be perhaps helpful for us to get a bit of insight onto that. So are members happy with that proposal? Jamie?
Thank you. I don't want to carry on too long on this, but if it transpires, yeah, you're right, we should ask those questions, and you can copy paste my comments from the official report and stick it in a letter to the Cabinet Secretary, but I know the clerks will cover all those issues and the questions that we do ask to get the answers that I think we need. Whether or not we get a response is another matter, but if we are where we are and it does transpire that the status quo remains for a period of time because the contract has been renewed or extended or whatever the situation is for a period of time, I presume that's going to be in the years, not the months. Is there anything the government can do in the meantime? And I'm quite keen to probe this, and perhaps in the same letter. Is there an interim solution whereby the government, and I don't think the numbers are huge here, so I'm not asking for millions of pounds, but is there a mechanism the government could provide for victims who do require access to transcripts, that funds could be made available to them to support them in that. That could be delivered or administered by a third party, such as one of the or charitable organisations or other publicly funded organisations who work with victims, who may manage the fund. That it could come out, for example, the proceeds of crime money, which we know is sort of often hotly disputed. That would be a perfect way to spend that kind of money. So no one should have to crowdfund in future to do this. And, it, you know, we're talking peanuts. I know it's still thousands of pounds, but to support those individuals in what are quite stressful situations, surely the government could find a few bob somewhere to create a fund if we're stuck where we are with the contract that we have. In the future, if all that comes down, it becomes more cheap, and then super, that's great, and the government will have done a good job in changing that. But in the meantime, we still need to do something.
And I'm happy for us to incorporate that into correspondence to the Cabinet Secretary. And obviously, we've got the bill coming forward. And in terms of the new contract and I suppose the process around that, that may be something that will be incorporated. I'd be very surprised if it wasn't. Okay. Are members happy with that proposal? Okay, thank you very much indeed. So that concludes our public session for this morning, and we'll now move into private session. Thank you.